meditated. I did my chin-ups. I took a walk. I jerked off. I was like, I've done everything I can think of here, and I worked through this.
I'm jazzed! Let's go! Let's do this! Woo!
I saw a tiger and a tiger saw a man. I saw a tiger.
So fucking awesome.
I am so glad that we are live again. Ah! Ah! My feet are like hell! Woo! Fuck! Ah! Hey, long walkers, welcome to Long Walk Short Drink, episode 84. This is Palmer podcasting to you live again. Woo! From Dayton, Ohio. I just got the notification on my phone. We are officially live. Welcome, Long Walkers.
Oh, this is Dave talking to you live from my basement in Northfield, Minnesota. Right before we went live, Palmer gave out the greatest, like, full-throated, like, woo!
Oh, man, it was so
spectacular.
This is so great! Oh, man. So welcome. We are back live again, and we are here on the, I'm going to try this chat, see if I can chat with them.
Yeah, Moto and Double D are on, and they were talking some shit about us before, about how we never start on time, which is true.
Oh, man, yeah. Well, and I mean, it's understandable. Well, I was worried. So when I first I started so early this morning. I've been doing a lot of this research on this, but really got into the thick of it. I was like, you know, we're not going to record until the afternoon. So that if you get up and you have your coffee with Ash and then you can get in and you can get this all set up, it should be fine. Boy, man, the technology plateau is real. But this was super. This is a lot easier.
Oh, this is going to distract us all day, but now we got, that's probably John from the Podcast Bros Network.
Awesome. Thanks for joining us.
So cool.
This is fantastic. I love the integration with the chat right here. It looks good. It did give a warning when I signed up for the service. It gave a warning that even though we select high def and we were trying to get like the best quality and all that, because of the COVID situation, there's just a huge amount of bandwidth getting eaten up on every service. So we might not get the full potential of what this service is capable of quality wise until things start getting back to normal and the normal bandwidth comes back down. So,
yeah, it's like it's funny with all of the stuff I've been seeing on TV or whatever. There's so much content. Oh, I hate that word. There's so much of the programming, I'll say that, that basically looks like our show has always looked, even before it was a video podcast. This we always talked on video chat, so it's funny just to see the whole world like that now. And it's great that we can be back at it too. I don't know if you want to shout out the service that we're using, but it seems pretty slick.
Yeah, StreamYard is the name of this service, so.
Yeah, Palmer found this and he's made it happen.
Yeah,
thank
so
you, sir.
We're back live. I have to admit, I could not have imagined how much that really was going to be a piece I missed, but it really was. So, I left a low hanging fruit out there in the chat for Double D. I'm just waiting for it. So.
Oh, I see. Well, you got a quite a look going on here today. That it's hidden by the headphones a little, but you're rocking like a mohawk, like a road warrior mohawk.
Yeah, no dress code in quarantine, right? So
that's right. There it is. That's what she said.
That's what she said. Yeah, you got a mic stand, buddy? Like,
oh, me?
Yeah.
I had it set up, but I hated it. It was making me literally physically furious, and so I'm like, hey, I don't need to tear any of this mic stand. I don't need to hold anything else.
And I'm sure they would appreciate the shenanigans. Do you have an alternative so you don't have to sit there and hold that thing in front of your face?
Oh, I see. Well, no, I just, you know, hold it up to my mouth real close and it's no problem.
LWSD ASMR with your host, Dave. Hey, guys.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Yeah.
Are you flowing? That's the first thing I say to you.
And there's our copyright strike.
Boom! Right.
Damn.
Yeah, I wonder.
No
monetization
on this one. Fuck.
Retire on all those pennies. Actually, I've never so much as seen a penny from any monetization anywhere.
Yeah, Double D, we waited 26 minutes for you not to have a mic stand.
This is so weird.
Like it's like,
I don't want one.
Yeah.
This is how I roll now. Yeah.
Shut up. This is fantastic. Oh, it's so good to be back. Shit.
He does raise a good point about how I'm gonna get the audio of the beer. We'll figure it out.
And this is the day drinking episode. I was just gonna say we need to open a beer.
Yeah. Here. Well, I guess I'll do a can. I was gonna do a bottle, but that's a good point. So I'll always have a can around. I didn't realize this would be a sticking point for the audience.
All I have is can.
Where is the mic stand?
Hey, really glad you guys are. Oh no, fucking mic stand, amateurs.
Rocking this mic like Simba. It's hot in here now. I was cold.
Ugh, that is a fantastic shirt.
Yeah, look at this magic. Yeah. Stand up or something.
Oh, all the red
T Public, man.
Like we're able to brand this, all this stuff to match using our colors. So all the reds match. It's great.
Yeah, I took my cue from the Pod Bros, and set up a T Public store to get myself a Long Walk Short Drink shirt.
That's awesome.
Yeah, rocking it today. I've had it for a little while. The first size I ordered didn't fit, and they were really cool about making that happen for me. Maybe someday when the people have money again or something, we can make it so others can buy it.
Absolutely.
It was funny because I bought it from us essentially, and I think it was absurd the little amount of money that, that came back to me that I spent, but it was worth it. I can't remember. It was whatever, but it's not about the money. I wanted the shirt. Yeah. And I have a notebook too. That is pretty cool that I've been keeping my Long Walk Short Drink centric notes, which I have a ton of, but for stuff that we may end up talking about. But yeah, let's crack a beverage. Let's live up to this day drinking.
Yeah, what are you drinking? What do you got?
Funnily enough, so I am going to be drinking a Christmas ale that I dug out and chilled overnight. But I wanted one other beer handy, and the one that I found in this drawer is from Indeed Brewing, and it just so happens to be called Stir Crazy Porter.
Oh, that's perfect.
So that's what I'll be. What about you? What you got?
The bottle he has is the Stand Stout. No, it's not. But that would be awesome if it was.
It would be.
Yeah. No. I have. So I'm a huge fan of the Voodoo Ranger line and all the different variants that they have. So this is one of their limited editions out right now, which is called Starship IPA, and it is awesome. So.
Yeah, they even got the font going. They must have. They must be just skirting the copyright. Razor's edge.
Yeah.
Star Wars copyright infringement.
But it's delicious. It's a really good one. So let's on three.
Okay.
Let's have at it. On three and three. Oh, on my face! It got me on my face. Welcome to, like, this is a Saturday recording. That's a first. It's the middle of the day. That's a first. Oh, I really like this day drinking. We should, like, reserve a day drinking episode for every now and then.
Yeah. I don't know why we never thought to record on a Saturday or something.
Yeah. No, that's fantastic.
I guess sometimes, you know, when life is in full swing, you know, we have things to do outside of the house.
But. Yeah, Saturday is like your catch-all day, right? Where you're just going to, like, run all day and...
A lot of errands and stuff like that we often do.
Yep. So, oh, man. So how's quarantine treating you?
Better some days than others. Just got a milk, porter mustache. I have been getting an awful lot done, which makes me really happy. And I really realize how much of a gift my creative drive is. But I don't mean like a gift to others. I mean like how vital it is to my own sanity. Like the stuff that I feel so compelled to make, really, like, is my, I never realized how much that simple act is a part of my mental health. So, I have been continuing to get up at like six. So I'll go to bed pretty early. Like I'll try to get in bed at 9:30 and watch a Mad About You on DVD and get lights out by 10. Oh, and then I get up at six and I try to edit my own stuff until about 9. And then I switch gears to work. And, you know, I've been doing great in terms of like my mood and stuff. Like 9, I'm usually feeling great, even if like I haven't accomplished a ton. Like just the act of it. Documentary moto. Actually, I have finished something, not a documentary, but a trailer, and that I could share. Then I noticed though that like throughout the day, it's been difficult some days. Like I've had so much trouble with this internet thing making it happen. I should preface this with I saw this, I don't know who said this, but I made a lot of sense to me, where someone was saying we're all in this. Oh shoot. I wrote it down and I didn't think I'd need to reference it, but of course I do. We're all in this, thing together, blah, blah, blah. We're all weathering the same storm, but we are not all in the same boat. So let me first say that before I complain about my internet, et cetera. Now I don't even want to. How have you been doing?
Oh, come on.
I can't, I guess. It's just so stupid. And it's made me so mad. it's a long story.
I gotta move this camera up because I can't sit up then there we go.
Oh well, yeah, you gotta be comfortable. Don't worry about headroom on my there you go. Great.
Yeah. Headroom. Oh, okay.
But yeah, so I've had a lot of trouble with the internet, and had to go out a few times in the, you know, when we're supposed to shelter in place and stuff like that, because I actually do need it even for my job. In fact, for my job, like I need the fastest fucking internet you can get, because I need to upload giant literally 4K video files and stuff.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Those are huge.
And of course now everything is video calls. Yeah. We're out of control. We're out of control. But anyway, so it's just been a lot of headache, and then I can't remember when we last talked. Like, did I talk about a 13-hour day fighting with this on the show? I can't remember. I had one of those.
No. But I mean, I think that is, I've had a few of those. It just comes with working from home. I hate it. I hate that. Like.
Yeah. And that's, yeah. And it's just, I don't know. It's like, and the other thing too is like, so Spectrum, which is our internet company, is providing free internet to anyone who didn't have it wireless, so that people can, you know, do their studies online and all that's happening. But, the bride and I both need to be on a lot of video calls. I'm recording video calls as basically, you know, video shoots for my job now. And, it's just, we haven't, been having, I mean, we've been having like, we were having like legit just like internet problems, and then trying to get the actual like upgrade, and I don't know, it's been a shit show. And one of the more egregious things, other than like literally the interminable hold times, because everybody is having these problems and everybody's getting free internet, so like the company is overwhelmed. But one time, so they couldn't like send me a strong enough signal, or they couldn't switch over to high speed internet or whatever. So it's like you don't have the right modem. We'll have to ship you one. I'm like, okay, how long will that take? They're like, a week. I'm like, well, that's not gonna work. Can I pick it up somewhere? And they're like, yeah, you could, you know, pick it up at this location. So I drove there. It was like an hour round trip during a snowstorm, ultimately too. And I get there, and the person that would help me was just mad at me already.
What?
Like, and they're like, and then when they found out what I was there for, she's like, you have the right modem. And like, she was just such a raging, she was a horrible, but that's the thing. It's like, people are at the end of their ropes, you know, and everybody is extra stressed and,
right.
And the majority of the many service people I dealt with and talked to, I was able to have the presence of mind to be like, they're not doing this to you. Be nice to them.
Right.
And it was no problem. I'm just being this together and just, and those have all gone great. This was one of the few times I went in and they were just like, what do you want? Or like, you shouldn't even do this. Like, well, your fucking people told me to come here that I had to come here to get a different modem. And you're telling me I don't. Anyway, that was one of many things. What am I getting? Oh, so I've just been frustrated by shit like that. Frustrated by things coming out of the work situation and all of those kinds of things. I guess like I'm just droning on about nothing here, but I even had like a full on meltdown though, like the other day, like this week. It was when the Orange Menace was talking about pulling out funding for the World Health Organization or something like that. I can't really handle a lot of news what passes for news these days. So I basically listen to a couple times a day, I listen to the 5-minute NPR update for just like what's happened. And they rarely play clips of him talking, which I really appreciate. And they just tell you what's going on. But they did. And there was just like a few stories in a row. It's like this that was canceled by Trump, and then this, and I literally just like fell to my knees and started crying. I'm like, this asshole is going to get us all killed. And just also that he doesn't have to admit he said a fucking word wrong so much, you know. And so I was just losing my mind. I was losing my shit literally for about 20 minutes. And then I finally got it together. And then the next day, after some frustrating shit, I got the internet going. It's been better since then.
Yeah. I can imagine that's a huge, huge weight. Connection. We live in this weird time where digital connection can. I remember growing up when in the 90s, especially the late 90s, when in the big like dot-com boom, there was a lot of things that we take for granted now were very new. Online dating, chat rooms, online gaming, all of those different things. And they were all kind of deemed like, what's the word? I'm going to mispronounce it, I think, but superfluous or whatever. Like, you know, like they're meaningless because they're online. And now they've become so ubiquitous and such an alternative. And then because of this social, like this is a great social experiment too, that we're in the middle of. And so one of the conduits of that social experiment is the fact that we are depending on, it doesn't feel like we're trapped at home because we're connected literally to the world at our fingertips on the pocket size supercomputers that we have, you know, or any of the screens that we have connected. Like we have two iPods going, two laptops going, a desktop, you know, our television's connected to the internet. Like, and I'm sure that's a good cross section of a lot of households and, you know, it's a lot for two people. It's kind of embarrassing when I think about it, but you know, because I'm sure there's families of four that have less connections than we do. Twinkie, I'm looking at you probably. But yeah, I really think that it's getting the internet is really a great way. an easy way to feel reconnected to the world, where I feel like in the 90s, that if we would have, if this would have happened in the 90s, the internet wouldn't have been considered an outlet for that social interaction. I really think that that helps. That helps being trapped in the house, knowing that you can just text 18 people if you want to at once. You can go live on YouTube and drink with your buddy halfway across the country still, you know, and and that all takes the internet. So that getting connected is, that's a crucial thing. So that I don't think that's anything to be embarrassed about at all, or to be hesitant to share, that, you know, it took getting connected to the internet to really feel that's the age we're living in, and what an age to be in, you know, to.
Yeah, it is pretty great that this is an option. You know, I've had some really, I mean, obviously this is, yeah, it's easy to take for granted, I guess. And yeah, like last weekend, it was my niece's birthday. And so we had like a Zoom birthday gathering for her. And it was fun to see her like shove the cake in her face and stuff like that. So, which obviously without this technology, that would not be an option. You know, you could do it over the phone, I guess, and hear things. But yeah, in a lot of ways, or maybe not a lot of ways, but I feel as though I've been way more social, or even forced to be more social at work, etc., have more conversations through this than I normally do, you know, actually. So I think I talked about this last time. So it's like, for, you know, an introvert of my caliber, requires an awful lot of like solitude to feel normal. I've been forced into an awful lot of conversations by the circumstance. It's weird. It's like ironic, but obviously the big thing is the physical presence and ability to just, you know, hug. Like I couldn't, you know, it's, we did a drive by birthday thing too.
We did one of those. Yeah. It's weird, right? Like,
Yeah. And we're wearing the masks now and stuff. Somehow I had a few of those proper, like, what do you call them? ND something or other masks.
Yeah.
Wearing those and some surgical gloves we found around, like going to the grocery store.
We made masks, using handkerchiefs and coffee filters. And, Ash found a really nice tutorial that, like, a good rule. I mean, you never know. This is probably, I don't want to even spread misinformation, so I'm just going to keep that to myself. Just follow the CDC recommendations on making a mask. I'm going to try to be responsible. Shit. Well, until I get a few more of these beers in me, I guess. I mean, we're in the same boat. Work, really, I kind of had a breakdown at work, and I to be careful about what I say about work. We have a really big project that's coming down on the team that I'm working on right now, and my role that I'm in, I'm still in a training position. So my role that I'm in has a piece to this project that is a major stepping stone to the project getting off the ground. And I'm a trainee involved in it with all of my support does not have experience in the type of program or the type of project that I'm working on. And so I really was getting overwhelmed, you know, why, if this is so crucial, why in such a big program, such a big project, like why was a trainee put in this place? So that just took some honesty, and I have some good pieces in places. And because of that support, like knowing that, like I feel like in a good place, but it was a really rough, like Tuesday, like Monday hit us hard. Last week was hard. We had a death in the family that non-COVID related, but completely unexpected. And so that's weird because we can't like go and be with our family that we really need to be with, that really could use having family around. Luckily there's family that's close that was willing to break some quarantine rules and or social distancing rules and kind of compromise that, just because, you know, you have to make those choices, I guess. And as long as you're minimizing that contact and not going outside of that core group now that you've just made bigger, that's really what you do, you know. I guess that, I don't know, it's a slippery slope. But Jesus, what do you do when somebody dies and needs and their partner needs people there, you know? Like, there's nothing else you can do. So
yeah. That's so tough. I forget what we have talked about on and off the show. I know we didn't talk about that, but we've talked off air, and I feel terribly that you're to go through that. And it's easy to forget for me, because I'm so fortunate to be you know, in a boat, as it were, with no holes, you know.
Right.
And
right.
You know, really comfortable and healthy, and the bride is healthy, and we've had no, you know, nothing in the families that anybody being sick or scares of being sick. It just feels like this thing that's happening to other people to some extent. And so we haven't had like some of those. I mean, we had a real challenge with Jeff, I guess. We came like millimeters away from losing our latest rescue dog, Jeffrey. But that was also, God, that was a huge stressor. I just remembered. But,
yeah.
But yeah, these things, and thankfully, you know, the vets, we work with so many just like saintly, our main vet, I don't know if I should say or whatever, but like, she is a saint, gave us her home cell number, and just, she's been a saint, but now she's like on a whole other level helping us with everything. But yeah, I forget about, I mean, like, I'm making videos for people, and there's like all these, like all these essential right. workers, as they're described, having to interact with the public and all of that stuff. It's insane. And then of course, yeah, things like you just described, you know, a death in the family that you don't, that kind of thing is so hard. It's hard enough. Like, how you can't even like go through the grieving process physically the way that it would be, you know, be there for others and all of that. It's
yeah. And, on top of any of the, you know, any of the adaptations that you do to get through it, which this is a loss that I am like 2 degrees separated from. So I definitely don't, this loss is greatly impact. I mean, it still impacted me a lot, but I, you know, it just gets compounded the closer you get to the loss. And, so I don't want to speak on their behalf, but just the idea of humans are adaptable. So there's going to be some, you're going to get through this, and it's going to be some kind of grieving process, whatever that looks like in this current situation. But then the one that really hit us hard was that when things start to go back to normal, and then we do act, there are actual services held, like, then that has to start all, it's almost like it has to start all over again. So,
oh yeah. Yeah. You'll have to start back from, like, the healing will have to begin all over again.
Yeah. So,
oh my,
I don't know.
I'm so sorry going through that. What sorts of things have you been doing? You know, people talk about the importances of routines and all this stuff. How have you been, what have you been doing? Not like what have you been doing fun, but like how have you been able to make the best of things?
Well, I mean, everything's Groundhog Day. I think everybody's going through that. Who's trying to social distance properly, right? Or whatever that means, right? So, you're social distancing, you're staying in your house, and we really quickly turned into this like Groundhog Day version of ourselves, where like Ash, both of us are lucky enough that with our jobs that we're able to work from home. So that is a blessing. As much as I hate working from home, I did that for about 7 years. As much as I hate working from home, it is a blessing during this time for that to be an opportunity for us. And so both of us work from home. So she works actually in this space upstairs during that time during the week. And then I work downstairs in the pinball parlor, just because my whole thing is with that. Now, I have barely played any pinball just because that space is like tainted. Like, it's like I spend all day in there. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I do.
Imagine
yeah.
being in your media area, right? Yeah. Like for 8 hours a day.
I've been for 12 because of my own stuff. Yeah, and so yeah. like,
and so like you get out of there, you
don't, I get out yeah, of this
you,
space.
You don't want to be in there. Right. And so, that was a little challenging for sure. But the reason being is because I didn't want to, when the opportunity came for us to record, cause I had a feeling this was going to be longer than just a few weeks or whatever. Like we're at a month now, right? And pretty much for us, and longer for more impacted areas like Washington. Washington went about 2 weeks sooner than us, and New York was about a week sooner than us. And I would have to imagine that you may have been maybe a week behind us. So maybe you're at like the 3 week mark, right? Like,
I think we're around a month. Someone else said that. I had a very strange concept of. Yeah, time.
But here's the thing: is like one great thing about Groundhog Day is I feel like the weekends just come. They like they're over in the same amount of time. They always feel like they go quickly, but they're right back because the week just flies. You know?
Yeah, I've experienced that a little too. Weird stuff though. It's like days feel long.
Yeah,
but weeks feel short somehow.
Yeah, but you don't care. I don't carry the day with me. Like, you know what I mean? I think that's part of it because
I've been doing a bad job of that.
So yeah.
I've been a nightmare for the bride, unfortunately. Well, I'm hoping that will change.
Luckily, my job, both of our jobs are pretty much at the end of the day, they stay there, you know? So like I'm working at my kitchen table, which is in my pinball parlor, you know? And, so I'm at that table in there. Right. And, I can keep my job at that table. So when I get up away from it, like it's done. Right. So, but I didn't want to work in this space and taint it for when the opportunity, because I knew I would need to talk to you, like, and I would need to record, and I'd want to look forward to coming into this office instead of dreading it. So, that was the choice that I made, and it paid off. I say we're responsible. We did, I did do as responsibly as you could be. It was pretty much hands off. Back and forth. We did a little bit of travel. We just have been like getting in the car and taking some road trips. So, but just staying in the car, like we're not going anywhere that we would have to get out or do anything. That's one way we've been getting out of the house. I don't know how responsible that is, but it, as long as we're staying in the car, I think we're all right, I guess. Other than when we have to go and like yesterday we bought a lot of booze that I've noticed this like trajectory change in like what, when it first started, we were getting a lot of groceries and supplies, and it wasn't even like the toilet paper. We were fine on all that stuff. It was like food. I was like, we need to, like, I want a month's worth of meals. Let's make sure that we have a month's worth of food that we can get through. And it took us 2 weeks to really get to that point. And we've kind of been eating off of that stuff now. And so those first 2 weeks were a lot of groceries. And now this week it was like mostly booze. We bought like all booze. So because we drank all the, pretty much all the good stuff that we had. And like Ash was like, you know, when week one, we had one bottle, like it took a week for the bottle of whiskey to come down onto the counter from the, like, cause we have the liquor bottles up on top of the counters. You know what I'm talking about?
And, yeah.
And yeah. She's like, it took a week for the Bushmills to be like down on the counter. And she's like, it took 1 week for one bottle. She's like, now there's five bottles of liquors like down on the, so what can you do, you know?
I hear that's happening a lot.
So but
we've actually been there have been some kind of, well, the one nice development that occurs, well, I guess there's two in terms of like activities. It's kind of funny too though, because it's like one of the things I found I missed most when someone asked me, I had to think about it, was I do miss driving. Like that's when I would listen to something, you know, book on tape or music. And I was just getting into this kick with listening to a bunch of Pearl Jam stuff and looking forward to that. And yeah, there's nowhere to drive to. And so when I was really furiously trying to like reframe my experience of having to drive to, you know, be meanly told I had the router I needed or modem I needed. I was like, you're listening to this new Pearl Jam album. You're loving it. You're getting to drive through a snowstorm. Just be cool, you know? but yeah, without all that drive time though, I have more time. Like I've been doing 3 days a week. I was up to 2 days a week around the beginning of the year, but now I'm 3 days a week karate in the garage.
Nice.
So that's been nice and fun. And I also shook that up in that I added songs with words. So for almost 3 years now, I've been doing all just like the same, probably 20 minutes of JCVD soundtrack music. Doesn't have singing. And then I started adding in like the Stan Bush songs and one of the first times one of them came on in the shuffle, I literally started just cracking up. I'm like, I can't believe this is great. It was just like, and it wasn't even, I think it was No Retreat, No Surrender. So it was like, there comes a time when you face the truth alone. And it's just like, what am I doing? And so I've been having fun with that. I sent you guys the slow-mo recording.
Oh, that was fantastic. You got to tweet that out. When this comes out.
I don't know if I can, because I told you about that Joseph Arthur video where I saw him on social media doing shadowboxing, and it ruined him for me as an artist, like a musical artist. Like I can't deal with it. Maybe, I don't know. I'll think about it.
Don't you want to ruin a dream for some other, like someone else?
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah,
yeah. I would deny them that.
But you gotta pay it forward, man.
That's true. Yeah. I'll tag Joseph Arthur.
Jesus, I am smitten with this. This looks fucking fantastic. This looks so professional. This, like,
crawl.
This didn't exist this morning. Jesus.
It is beautiful.
Sorry.
What you've done here. No, that's all right. There's no wrong time for an enthusiastic outburst like that. Where we normally will walk the dogs and stuff, I guess I can't quite say, but we couldn't go there. And so we went to this other like paved path that was we actually avoided a lot because it was where I lost my shit. Was it last year? Like I screamed at this guy and his kid. So it was kind of like the scene of the crime. So we weren't going there. But so we went there and then we discovered that we didn't have to be on the paved path, that there is actually, rather the bride found this out, I guess it's most often used by bikes, but it's right along the river and it basically feels kind of like the state parks we've been in. And, nobody has been out there except for the occasional, cyclist. And so that's been amazing actually. And we would not have discovered that had this not, happened. And, so that's nice. I don't know what else. I mean, other than my like mood swings and, I don't actually have to carry the work that I'm asked to do into the evenings or anything like that, but my emotions can get the better of me, and then the bride is stuck trying to deal with my man babiness.
So I have had a couple meltdowns too. Like I said, on Tuesday was one of those, and Ash and I have had a couple, like that was a fight, and then there was a couple times that we have had, but all in all, we have both commented multiple times about how well we're doing through all of this.
Oh, that's
like,
awesome.
Like, and how fun we're having with it. And
that's awesome though, that you are that you're doing so well in that regard that you would actually remark on it to one another.
Yeah. Like, well,
that's terrific.
It's really easy. I think part of, I get overwhelmed with trying to deal with just the uncertainty as like the bigger stuff gets. And so it's really easy to contain everything when you're just trapped in the house, you know? So,
Oh, that's funny. 'Cause I have struggled with the uncertainty. of a lot. I guess I'm trying not to think about it, so I don't even want to delve into it too much. But I did say, like, that's something that I struggle with in general. And the bride said to me on one of these days when I was having a tough time, she's like, "You really, bro, you got to really get better at, you know, dealing with uncertainty." I'm like, okay, yeah, I know. I'm a fucking meditating on the therapy. I've been doing everything I can fucking think of for the last few years to try. Like, that's not news to me. And some days it is. I have noticed too that one of the practices that I've been doing is I have that like bullet journal type thing, and I have reframed it to not just write down what I've done, but try to write what I've done well. I think maybe I even told you this last time or something like that. And so that has helped me think about, like, oh, you know, I had this tough day, but I dealt with it well, or I did this. Like, I also have these little post-it notes that I put on every day. I was doing it for every week, and then I just got them for every day, and I put them at the bottom of the page. And it's stuff that, like, a checklist that I want to
do. Nice.
So it's like, worked, I don't know if I can get it to focus, worked an hour, at least an hour on my original creative projects. And that's been great. I've been rocking three most days. 15 chin-ups, which I got back to. Meditated. Walked with the bride and or the dog. Karate in the garage, 15-minute interval training. Met my Fitbit goals. Journaled and focused on what I accomplished / did well. And so I'll notice that, like, trying to meeting those and checking them off gives me satisfaction. Or just if I am having a tough day, to like, well, did I do this yet or did I do that yet? And I find that, like, oh, I actually worked through my bad mood or whatever by doing these things. Little shout out to the 10%. I think it's 10% is the app. I've tried various meditation apps over the years, and this one I really like. Actually, the last therapist I was seeing advocated for it, and it has like a training. So it's, I think I told you about it over the holiday, like Christmas holiday, where it's like Dan Harris, I think is the dude's name, I hope I'm getting that right, who was a ABC anchor who had some sort of like on-air meltdown or freeze or something like that, and somehow it led him down this path.
I have read that guy's book. I mean, like,
you did
that. That's the guy's book that I was reading. I never finished it, but he How I learned to I'll have to see if I can dig that book out on when we go on our pee break.
Yeah. That's great. I didn't realize.
No, but I have that. It and it has his meditation method in the back. I've been telling myself, like, you need to get that out and you need to start doing just that piece, because I got like 2/3 of the way through the bulk of the book is just a biography that led him to that.
Mm. Oh, okay.
And it's really like dramatic and dramatized. Exactly what you would expect somebody who is a news anchor who ends up who ultimately is going to turn this into a business. I think he even knew when he wrote the book that he was going to try to market the technique and everything, which is what this sounds like. I know he has like an app that he has guided meditate this guided meditation and everything.
So it is what I have, but it's not like his participation in it is only as an interviewer to these various people.
Yeah,
and so he interviews them from a pretty objective standpoint, and he's like, "Well, I do this, and like I have trouble with this, and like, that's all fine and good." But like, so each of these things, they'll be. They're like little packs, and they're different meditating. Actually, the people interviewed aren't always like one of them is meditation for skeptics, or one of the most useful ones I found was this thing on emotions and relationships. Anyway, there's all different people. So it starts with like, I think the longest interview parts have been like push 5 minutes, and some are short as like 90 seconds or something like that. And then there'll be a guided meditation after that's kind of on theme, and then you work through these packs. But something about the combination between the different people that you get to hear from and the different tracks you can take, and then that interview / training portion has been the best experience I've had with these. And even to the point where I was like, I don't need to go to the therapist I was seeing anymore, because he's just telling me this shit, and this is like sustainable daily practice stuff that I can do on my own. And,
right.
Yeah, I've gotten a lot out of it. I really like it, And yeah, so I would recommend it to folks. I don't know. Yeah, he hasn't said anything about his own method. Like I'm not sure what that would be. And the only thing that I can see that's a consistent thing with all of this is just making time to do it, and just starting over in terms of like your concentration is like, that's the main thing. As long as you're doing that, then you're doing something and you're training your brain. And that was one of the interesting things that I didn't need convinced to do it by this therapist guy, but he was telling me about this thing. He's like, you know, do you floss? I'm like, yeah, I floss. And he's like, well, when I was younger, that wasn't really a thing. And like dentists wouldn't even floss. And so it's like, you know, times change. And like now you'd never meet a dentist who doesn't floss. And he's like, I happen to know through the research I've done all these years that you won't meet a neurologist who doesn't meditate. I was like, oh, that's fucking interesting. And so anyway, that's been helpful. Wow. I mean, I say that on the one hand and also say that I've had like a lot of troubles, but I just one of those tools that I've used. So like on some of these days, I'm like, okay, I meditated. I did my chin-ups. I took a walk. I jerked off. I was like, I've done everything I can think of here, and I worked through this.
Oh, I'm so glad the jerking off is still in there for not just me. It's all in the repertoire. Yeah. I mean, anyway. Listen, man, it's fucking stir crazy. Like, it gets really. This is like the time that I'm really nervous. Even I was ready. There's a pinball machine that's for sale down in Nashville, like 5 hours away.
Oh,
right. And it's like, it's a really fantastic price. I ended up working out a deal and I put a deposit down on it. But like, I was ready to go get it and not.
Oh, right before all this happened?
No, like I was going to go get it tomorrow.
yeah, I see.
You know, and because
I mean, couldn't you and still somehow be, well, you probably couldn't move it on your own, huh?
So I would take Ash with me. She is amazing she and I we can move a machine no problem, just the two of us.
Nice.
We have it down to a science now. So part of we even considered going out to Pennsylvania to help support our family. That was part of the reason why I didn't go to Nashville tomorrow. Ultimately, I didn't go to Nashville was because this machine is en route, which means it's out in the wild for people to play, and it's in a bar that is closed down right now until May the 1st because of the like stay at home orders. And so, which is good because that means I know the public can't be playing the machine and beating up on it during this whole time. Right. And so, the guy was like, no, come down. Everything's open. Like come down on Sunday and we can get it out. And, it's not going to work out because the place is closed until May the 1st. There's no getting in. And so, which I'm totally fine with in hindsight. Cause I'm like, we were going to go out to Pennsylvania, and our thinking was we don't have kids, so we wouldn't be exposing kids to anything. It would just be ourselves. It's really easy. If one of us was going to get it, both of us were going to get it anyways. Again, that's only if one of us got it. Of course, we're trying to avoid situations that both of us would get it. But like, you know, when we need to get supplies and we need to go out grocery, we go up together because we're going to get infected. If one of us is going to get infected, both of us are going to get infected, right? And so our whole thing was it's really easy. It would be easier for us to, if we had to quarantine for 2 weeks, we could do that. We're already doing that now. So if we were willing to take the risk, why not? So I guess we could, and we did kind of last weekend. I did do a trade, but that was with somebody it was like one person, and Ash and I moved the machines in, moved the machine out. We didn't interact with the person at all.
I don't know. Did we talk about? Well, I guess we talked about when it was uploading. But like, I would love to see more. I would love for a regular feature on our YouTube page to be not just these live videos, but I loved the pinball adventure.
Oh,
I'd love to see more of that.
Well,
more road tripping even.
Like, yeah. Well, footage I from think that part. So. I did put a deposit down on that machine in Nashville, so that's going to be, we're definitely going to make some, we'll record some video of that trip down to Nashville to get that machine. It's pretty exciting. I'm going to save the title, but I will say it is one of the machines I have right now in my collection is the sequel to this machine that I bought, is a sequel to the machine I bought. So
I have an idea. I'd be wrong.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if you would. It's a, I don't know. I guess I could say it's Elvira and the Party Monsters. So I have Scared Stiff.
Oh shit! So, no, like, I did not know that.
Yeah. So this is the predecessor to Scared Stiff. So Elvira is like all over the cabinet. It's really her, and her boobs are all over the cabinet, which is fantastic.
Ooh la la.
But it was a really good price, a really good deal. So I took advantage of that. It was cheaper than the last five that were sold on this website that I use to find machines. So it was a good deal. And it looks like it's in pretty good condition. So, and it's a title I want to have in my collection. So you got to strike when the opportunity comes. But yeah, that's not happening until the first, but there will be more pinball. That will be a pinball adventure for sure. And I'll go all the way from us traveling down to Nashville to us bringing the machine home and setting it up, playing the first game in it. So nope, that's all there. So I'm excited for that too. We didn't record anything from this trade that we did last weekend just because we still felt it was irresponsible that what we were doing. And I did not want to promote people going out and doing stuff. So this. Oh, yeah. Boobies. You got it. let me find the back glass, because the back glass. Here, hang on. This is so hilarious.
Ooh.
Yeah, so that's the bat. I mean, that's what you stare at.
I got dumped, guys.
The whole game,
Logan would say.
Yeah, I got a dump. Yeah, I gotta take a dump.
Wow, that's something.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So Scared Stiff was super. So Scared Stiff is the machine that I feel like that's like the best machine to explain pinball to people who don't understand pinball, who don't play pinball regularly. It's really easy to wrap your head around the concept. It's really easy for that machine to change people's perception about pinball being a game of chance, and that it actually is a game of skill, because then you, once you know what you have to do, even an amateur player, so somebody who doesn't even play pinball at all, can walk up and they can do some of those tasks pretty easy on that machine. So,
oh, cool.
And I think Elvira and the Party Monsters is another take on that. And Elvira is just one of my favorite characters. Like, she's just, I love that midnight matinee and that, like, that campy, lurid. I don't know.
Go on.
Yeah, no.
Slower.
Yeah, yeah. No, exactly. Fuck, fits fantastic. So, anyways, yeah. So I have one of those in my collection. There's a third. It just came out actually at the end of last year. A brand new machine, Elvira machine. It's called Elvira House of Horrors, and it actually uses footage from
Horrors or Horrors.
No, I think Horrors, Horrors.
I bet that's slightly intentional.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
Or overtly intentional.
No, absolutely. But the cool one about this one, so you know how Jurassic Park and Star Wars has that LCD screen, right?
Oh, yeah.
So this one has an LCD screen like that, and it uses footage from that, you know, that Elvira show that is on Amazon Prime, like the Elvira's 13 Tales of Terror. So that show uses film, not all of the episodes, but some of the episodes use films that are in public domain. Night of the Living Dead being one of those, right?
Yeah.
So this machine uses footage that she recorded for that show. and also those movies that are in public domain. So Night of the Living Dead is in that machine, like
like
clips from that movie play in the game.
Yeah. Coming to get you, Barbara.
Oh man, yeah, exactly. And with Elvira commenting on those movies, so it's like her midnight matinee show during the gameplay. So I just love that character. That's the machine that made me fall in love with really fall in love with pinball. So I would ultimately love to have all three of those machines. So I have two of them now. I just haven't gotten the second one yet. So
sweet.
Yeah.
Oh, I look forward to that adventure.
Yeah. So, and then ultimately, and I'll be at capacity again. So I'll be at the maximum amount of machines that I have. So, but I recently traded, I can text you the photo. So the one that we kind of broke quarantine a little bit for, which I can't believe I admitted to. I was trying not to, actually. Was a Wizard of Oz pinball machine. So I traded my AC/DC machine.
Oh yeah.
For a beautiful Wizard of Oz, that needs some restoration done, which I'm capable of doing. But Aaron, I'll send you a couple of videos too. So those will be coming, so you can see that. So this guy and I had been talking before all this shit went down, before all the COVID shit went down, and we were going back and forth. He had a really good deal on the table at one point in time, and I kind of balked at it just because the amount of work that needed done really intimidated me, and he ended up doing the work, and the deal kind of changed at the last second, and it all came together, and we got a machine that we're really, 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 really excited about. So it looks like those all went through. So
that's great. Yeah, I can actually probably, do you want me to share any of these like with my screen? I bet I could.
Sure, go right ahead.
Okay, so we'll just do the image first.
There we go. So this is the machine that I got. This is Wizard of Oz Emerald City Limited Edition. This came out, this was built, these started getting released in 2013. So hopefully, ultimately, I would like to really build the pinball videos up, but there's a lot of history that goes into pinball. And I can, there's some great documentaries that kind of chronicle that history a little bit, but, which is ironic for this show, long story short, pinball imploded on itself at the end of the 90s, just like the .com era did. And so, all that was left was one company, Stern, who was still making pinball machines, and they were making pinball machines. They were the only company making pinball machines all through the 2000s into the early 2010s, until out of nowhere there was this new company came. They announced they were opening a facility. They were already had secured the rights on a really big property, and they were going to start production and be the second company to start making pinball machines in America since 1999, when Williams or 2000 when Bally Williams shut down their pinball division and focused strictly on making slot machines, leaving only Stern. So they were the one company. Jersey Jack Pinball ended up being the second company. This is the second Jersey Jack pinball machine I've owned. I had a Dialed In, which was their second title, second or third title, I believe. But Wizard of Oz was their first one. And this was the first limited edition of this title that they put out. This particular one has a couple really cool features too. Like the artwork is directly printed right onto the cabinet. It's not a decal that was applied to the cabinet. And then it was clear coated over that artwork. So it's like automotive clear coat. The cabinet is amazing. It's beautiful. The machine itself, this particular model was notorious for some manufacturing defects. One of which this one was plagued with, was some bubbling in the artwork on the play field itself, that bubbling actually lifted the artwork off. So there's wood exposed, like the artwork is gone and there's wood exposed on the play field. And that was the work that this ultimately is going to need to be brought back up to its former glory. It's going to need a play field swap, but it came with the play field. So it just takes a lot of work, and it's kind of outside of my experience that I've had so far with pinball machines. But I think that is going to generate a lot of content for Long Walk Short Drink, that work. I have some plans for that stuff.
I like the sound of that.
Yeah. So, this is it. The Wizard of Oz, it's beautiful. It has that beautiful green, emerald green trim, that amazing topper that interacts with the gameplay, that has the wizard there on the top of it.
Yeah, and I love that. That's very cool. I like how it's almost, I had to look closely to see, because it looks like it's hovering a little bit. Like
It's a piece of acrylic that's lit from LEDs, an LED strip that's at the bottom there. There were a few features. This was the LCD screen is massive. It's like a 25-inch screen, which was revolutionary. It has two upper play fields. Let's switch over. Can you play
movie?
If I
can play them, or yeah, if you want to, but I could do the same thing with one of the movies.
Yeah, let's see these videos. Let's see.
Okay, I'm gonna click play here.
So the sound, it's really choppy. It would be better if I but here, let me try to upload the videos.
It's choppy for you. Okay. Yeah. It was smooth here. But that makes sense why it would be.
Yeah, let me drive. So it's gonna take it a second to upload those videos. This game was like the first pinball machine to come out from a company that wasn't Stern in almost 10 years, over 10 years. So it was kind of a big deal in the pinball thing. And I remember when I was, so I got into pinball with the virtual machine, and I did that around our wedding. And then when we went on our like mini honeymoon out to Las Vegas, there's the Pinball Hall of Fame out there, which we went to, and they had this Wizard of Oz machine. They had a Wizard of Oz out there, and we each played it once. We played one game on it, I remember thinking like, oh my gosh, to ever own one of these would probably be amazing. And I said the same thing about Scared Stiff, and I have like, I'm just so, I acknowledged how blessed I am in the position that I am, that I have both of them and plus some, you know. So it is fantastic. It's a beautiful machine. The light show is great on it, which these we'll get to see with these videos here. Let me go into the drive real quick. All right, you ready?
Hold on, I'm just about to click. And I just ordered
You don't have to do that. You don't have to do that.
I just ordered a tabletop mic stand. I just hit the order side. Oh, that's all right, but you may need it.
Check this. Look at this.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, probably what I just got. But okay, I'm ready.
It's uploading the second one here. So let's. I'm going to try to play this first one while we're doing this. So let's see.
It's cool. It mutes us and then puts it right in the center there.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Here's the second one.
Okay. I like the commentary there.
Here's the thing about Ash's commentary. Ash is better at that game than I am. Her pinball,
really?
Her pinball skills have like drastically improved. Which really confirms what I was feeling about my collection that I have. Like, I feel like I have a good variety of titles and that have different gameplay enough that if you play them collectively, it really will improve your game. And that's really shown for both of us. She is, but she's better at this Wizard of Oz game than I am. It's amazing to watch her play. So, but it's a super fun game. It's a great project. Itches all my buttons. So, yeah. But I'm excited for it. I'm also excited for our first pee break. We might need to.
That works for me.
Okay. Awesome.
Yep.
I wonder how this one's looking.
So we've kind of caught up. We've gotten through the like the technical hiccups of using this new platform. I think so far so good. I'm really pleased with it.
Me too.
But man, so Mandalorian came up. Mandalorian came up. We've been chatting about it, but there's all the Tiger King stuff. Like, we kind of missed the mark on it being like still number one. It stayed number one for like the longest time on Netflix.
There's a chart for that. I thought they were so secretive about their
that stuff. It's like when we go in. See, this is the other thing too. There's such a disparity between which version of the app you go into. So on our TV, the version of Netflix that's on our TV, you know how it has like the different rows that have the different subgenres, and the row is full of that, whatever that subgenre is. One of them is like top in the US, and it has like a 1, 2, 3. It's like a 1 through 10.
Oh,
and then it has the cover art with it's got like a like an outline of the number, like a block letter outline of the number, and then that fits inside that number. So like if this was the number one, this would be the cover art, would kind of like be superimposed partially offset from the one. And for like 4 weeks in a row, almost 4 weeks in a row, it was Tiger King.
Nice. Yeah.
So it doesn't tell you the number of viewers, but it definitely ranks the top 10 viewed things in the U.S. on Netflix.
Oh, cool. Right. I'll have to keep an eye out for that.
So, and Tiger King was there for over 3 weeks, which was just a drastic, like, that's a ridiculous run. So, and then Ash and I just watched the follow-up episode with,
yeah, us too.
With John McHale.
Joel
McHale. Yeah. Joel McHale. So that was really interesting. It was great to see those characters. I mean, you're still seeing them through the filter of whatever that episode happened to be, but you didn't see it through the documentarian filters, which I thought was a unique take. But I felt like you got a really... they were obviously edited conversations, but they were hot takes for sure. You know, like were edited hot takes, you know? So
yeah, that one guy, what's his name? I pulled up the cast as it were here. Eric Cowie, the head zookeeper there.
Yeah.
The guy with the long blonde hair.
Yeah.
Like the last thing he said, right, was, oh, I actually did write this down because I was going to write down a bunch of stuff, and this ended up being the only thing I wrote down. So the first thing he said, they're like, Joel's like, how you doing? He's like, oh, loving life, loving Jesus.
Yeah.
And then the last thing he said was, fuck all y'all, man.
Yeah.
Cut away.
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy was awesome.
Yeah. And he had that was one thing I can say about that episode, Jeff Lowe aside, because that guy's a piece of shit.
So many pieces of shit.
They're all in some ways, the majority of the main players are all kind of pieces of shit. So Jeff Lowe aside, the rest of the people that they had on there were all kind of the ones that I at least could justify feeling positive for, you know what I mean? Like Saf, he was like the one that got his arm bitten off.
Yeah.
You know,
oh my God. Like the attitude, that dude's attitude is like unshakable. Or I mean, whether it's the bride was sort of suggesting that that person had probably developed a super thick skin for, so Saf, which I never got in the documentary, is a trans, what would you say, a person. Trans man, a trans person? And yeah. So, but like throughout the documentary, all of the other characters refer to Seth as a her, which was apparent, but like obviously. So anyway, he identifies as male, but that was never really discussed. There's no like name tags or anything.
Right,
or if
right.
it is, it's going to say Seth. It's not like his, hers pronouns or something. Anyway, but so the bride was sort of suggesting that some of the cavalier attitude that that person presents might have to do with being, you know, a trans person in the South and all these other things. But like, you know, got his arm eaten off by a tiger and showed up to work like what, within a week or something?
Less than
crazy.
A week, yeah.
Yeah. It's just, well, they were just like, yeah, it's no problem about this, that, or the other. And they're like, they misgendered you throughout. He's like, yeah, I don't care.
Yeah, it's okay. And this got kind of glazed over, but I just did it. Fuck. He talks about in the documentary how the next day he woke up and like Joe Exotic and his second in command are at the hospital, and they like put a pen in his mangled hand and like made him sign off that like. And it didn't really say what they were signing off, but I think it was like signing away the liability of Joel Exotic in the zoo.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Which is just, it's a very early example of how fucking manipulative this piece of shit is. I almost wonder if some of those people, he's a predator, and all of those people are predators in their own way, right? Like, Doc Antilles is a predator for like young girls and enticing young girls. And Joe Exotic is young men and the disenfranchised. Like his policy was like, if we get people that if this is the best place they can go, they'll never leave. You know, like that's the level of people that we're going for.
Yeah, like I'm struggling as to whether or not we should say just generally, because I'm guessing, like, for instance, maybe Moto hasn't seen this and I know he's watching. So it's but it's so fucking convoluted.
Yeah.
But the one line on IMDb anyway, it's like a rivalry between big cat eccentrics. Well, easy for me to say. A rivalry between big cat eccentrics takes a dark turn when Joe Exotic, a controversial animal park boss, is caught in a murder for hire plot. And I mean, if you can picture like a more redneck version of like a Bret Michaels or something like that, that's a joke, kind of what Joe Exotic looks like. He's got a two-tone mullet, like a blonde slash, it's like a, I don't know, it's a lot to get into, but it's such a convoluted story about these people who keep tigers, and it gets into so very much more, but that's just a general overview. So like, but all of them are kind of, it's weird though, because here's how I was introduced to it. Like, I'd heard about it, I went in though completely blind, and I didn't look up anything on the internet, because you can find a fuck ton about all of this stuff. The bride likes a lot of this true crime type stuff. Yeah. Moto's like, sounds like Real World meets Jersey Shore plus plus. I mean, yeah. It is definitely. Oh my God! And there is a reality TV segment or like, not segment. Component to it, because like one of the things is this one guy was basically filming a reality show at the zoo, or what he thought would be that, and it was kind of online, but anyway, but then the studio got burnt down. Anyway,
who was the indication that they thought burnt that down? Did Joe Exotic burn it down?
Oh yeah, I think so, so that there wouldn't be evidence of certain things.
Yeah,
I think was the idea there. Yeah. But so the bride likes a lot of true crime stuff. I'd kind of heard, you know, I'd seen the show art or something on when we'd launched Netflix. But she called me in. She was like, and she's like, you got to see this. And so she hits play, and it was one of his music video clips. So this guy is like standing on top of a car, acoustic guitar with this like mullet. And black leather pants, and maybe a tiger was in the shot, but he's like, it's just like the greatest cheesy country song. And it's literally like, he goes, I saw a tiger and a tiger saw a man. I saw a tiger and it helped me understand. And it was like, and all this, he's like, God. It's so
fucking awesome.
And there's like a fake hunter. There's like a dramatized hunter deciding not to shoot a tiger.
Who is his husband, by the way?
Exactly. Which I didn't know at the time. But this is what I first saw. And my mouth just like dropped. I'm like, what is this magic? And then it cut. I thought this was just going to be, because sometimes she'll just show me fun stuff from the internet or whatever. Like, it's real short, sweet. And she's like, I think you'd like this. I'm like, I most certainly did. Thank you. I married. Thank you for showing this to me. And then I'll leave. And so I watched that, and then it cut back to this guy with no shirt, all tatted up, very few teeth. And it's a wide shot of him in his house, and he was talking about what I just saw. And I was just like, hold everything.
Yeah.
I need to see
all
of whatever this is. And she's like, okay. So that was maybe episode 2 or 3. And then so we backed up and started watching it all. And so one of the things too about the show is like, there are so many different layers to this world and the people in it, characters and stuff, that at the end of each episode, they kind of tease what will come next. And you're like, what?
Yeah.
How could this possibly?
It is almost irresistible to binge all 7 hours, especially in the current situation that we're in, which I think helped fed into its popularity. You know, it's so bingeable. Even all the people on the follow-up episode said one of his common questions for all of them was like, how quickly did you watch the show? And most of them were like, the day it came out, I binged it. I binged all 7 hours as soon as it came out. And it Ash and I did it over a couple of days. I mean, it doesn't feel like you watch 7 hours worth of shit, but you really do. There's a lot that happens in that. And it's mesmerizing. It is a cast of we've talked about these characters like Illalilia and Mark Beauchard and Mike Shank and all this, like
this. Incidentally, you know who executive produced this bitch?
Who's that?
Chris Smith, the director of American Movie.
Oh, shit! Like, it is the entire, every person that comes on the screen is one of those people that could easily be, it 2 hours just of that person would be just as entertaining as the rest of what you're watching. And it's the entire cast is full of that. It's like, it's a literal gold mine. That's why you feel so bad for the guy who all his footage got burned up, because he knew what he had. He could have exposed this a decade earlier. He could have, you know, like when
What's crazy too, though. So we're talking about Rick Kirkham. He was like an inside. He's got
Inside Edition was where he started. Yeah.
Yeah. And so he was called in by Joe Exotic, the mulleted guy, to basically do a.
Because he smoked crack and he couldn't work in the mainstream anymore.
Oh, is that why?
Oh, see, yeah.
A lot of this stuff I have not heard about. And in fact, so
he answered a Craigslist ad and he was working on Inside Edition prior to that. I mean, just that, like, you know what I mean? Like, come on. Like,
right.
He goes from Inside Edition to a Craigslist ad. You don't just like, it's not like you just, you're just like, well, I'm done with Inside Edition. Let's go to Craigslist first and see what I have available. No, like crack. That's the gateway. That's how you get from Inside Edition to, which some would think Inside Edition is the bottom of the barrel, but. At least that's still television, right?
Yeah. Well, the thing that puzzled me about that too is like, yeah, it all got burned up and there never was a TV show, but we're looking at the footage.
Something had to have survived. And I think this is either private stuff that Joe had his own videographers following him all the time. And then the creators of the show did do some kind of documenting of this stuff, right?
Like, oh, sure. Yeah. Eventually, like
the interviews and all that stuff, right? Yeah. So,
but there's so much archival. I don't know. I definitely got the sense that we were looking at footage from
some of that stuff
from the reality show, because that becomes a big part of it. And they talk about how like Joe Exotic would fire people and behave erratically just for the cameras that were following him all the time, which first were coming from this Rick Kirkham. And Rick Kirkham was thinking like, oh, I can make this into the most amazing reality TV show about this quirky zookeeper. But
and he had him on a rock solid contract that gave him ownership of all the footage that he had shot with his own crew, but then also gave him ownership of all of the footage. Joe Exotic hosted his own internet television show.
Yeah.
That he produced, and he owned all of that, the hours of that too. And that really panicked Joe Exotic. I think that really...
Yeah, especially when Joe Exotic was like using that platform to like... So he had this rival of this this woman, Carol Baskin.
Carol Baskin! Oh, but Carol just to quickly, fucking Baskin!
Yeah. To really quickly tag up on that whole thing with the relationship between Kirkham and Joe Exotic was like Joe Exotic needed somebody, wanted somebody to help him run this like... TV station, internet station for him. And Kirkham was like, okay, I'll do that for you if I can make this reality TV show about you, which of course all Joe Exotic really wanted is to be famous, I think. Yeah. And so he was like, yeah, whatever. And, but he has this rivalry with this Carol Baskin who I think the rivalry, look at that mohawk. That's great when you rock it up like that.
Yeah. It looks like Sloth's hair.
Oh, I keep thinking of that guy from the Road Warrior.
It's that thin hairline, yeah. I can do kind of like a hipster look to it.
Oh, where, yeah.
Like swoop
that
over.
That really helps with the mohawk.
Yeah.
Like to give it shape. Yes. Boy. My hat's off to you for doing that. That's awesome.
No dress code. No dress code. In the apocalypse. You can have any haircut you want. So.
uh, Oh, the Carol. So I think the real rivalry started with this Carol Baskin.
I love
because
day drinking. Shit, is this fun? It's bright outside and beautiful, and I am.
You got a nice buzz going.
Schwazied. Oh, shit. That's all right. I'm sorry. Go ahead. So
oh,
Carol
no,
Baskin.
That's all right. I was trying to figure, try to remember, because like Joe Exotic, I found out just recently, like, I guess he was the like police deputy or like sheriff, not sheriff, something like that, or police chief or something in the small town where he was from. That they don't talk about that in the show, but like he obviously always wanted the limelight, and there was something like he was taking tigers around to like high schools and stuff to do like these little demonstrations and shows, and people, he was finding that people would pay better attention to him if he did magic, and then there became like this magic show, and I think eventually, and it kept like escalating in terms of like the showmanship and the wildness and being less about the wild tigers or kept tigers rather. But so
yes.
Oh, that should just stay. Can't get enough of that picture. For new listeners or viewers, Palmer, what is this picture we're looking at?
Schwazied.
Yeah, but what does it mean?
It means I'm drunk. It means you're either missing or about to be a part of something awesome. So, yeah.
That's great.
The record for this photo being shared with anybody was my bachelor party. The first day that I showed, it was a 2-day bachelor party, and I showed up to the hotel, and 15 minutes later, I text this picture to my wife because I, oof. Roadhouse. Nice.
What was I going to say? Oh, Carol Baskin. Oh, so, but then the thing, like, it, so with Carol Baskin, correct me if I'm wrong here, because it's all so convoluted, but I think then he started doing malls, and that's when, like, Carol Baskin, who's, like, this other, you know, big cat enthusiast and saving the tiger, supposedly, started, her and her husband, Howard Baskin, were from Big Cat Rescue, were trying to stop Joe Exotic from being able to do these appearances. And so once that started to happen, then this like rivalry started. So, but like basically it got to the point where Joe Exotic was like one of his music videos has, oh man, see that introduces that whole thing where Carol Baskin probably killed her former husband.
This is a fucking...
I don't even know how to like get into it. It's so much shit.
Just fucking watch it.
Yes.
Speaking of, like, seriously, it can't, there, we could give a whole 4-hour show just on that 7-hour show.
Yeah, and we're
not
a little late.
And not
it,
and we're a little late to it. We should have done it last weekend. I apologize.
Well, no, there's a death in the family.
Yeah,
that was what we were gonna do it. You had a death in the family, and we nearly lost Jeff. So like it was not gonna happen.
Yeah. We're a little late to it, but seriously, check it out, man. It's just bread and circus. It's pure entertainment.
Yeah,
and it is if you just watch it from a pure entertaining like standpoint, it is pure entertainment. Carol fucking, that bitch Carol fucking Baskin.
Yeah, well, and if you can somehow go into it without, I would recommend trying to stay off the internet, but don't look into it.
Yeah,
on your
just
own,
go watch
the ride they take you on. Is
if you are not one of the millions of people who have already watched it, like just go do that. Which Moto must be one of those people. So,
it is so worthwhile. This reminded me of one of our other segments that actually kind of ties in. So I have some shit the bride says quarantine edition.
Yeah, let's go through that. Let's go through.
So these are some, quarantine edition. It'll end with, should I start or end with Tiger King? I guess. I'll start with it. Why not? Because that makes sense as I'm looking at them. So I got three of them here. So this is March 28th. After watching 3 episodes of Tiger King, she goes, "This show is exactly what I wanted. There's 2 cults, 2 harems, a murder, soon to be murder for hire, and in the middle of all of it, tigers." And then same day, also March 28th, she goes, "I believe in revenge. Vengeance is a reason to live. For many, it's the only reason." And then just a few days before that, we were talking, you know, talking about going to the store. Something came up too where we were talking about irony. That comes up a lot, whether things are ironic actually or not. And I ask her, I go, should I wear cloth gloves to the store? Would that help? And she goes, fuck if I know. I'm not a doctor. I'm barely a person. And then after a few moments of reflection, she goes, that's irony, because I am a doctor. She's a doctor of philosophy. That is a PhD. But there, yeah, there's some shit the bride says. For Mandalorian stuff, I have a few of her asides throughout because I took notes per per show. I do have my Dave's Digs would be super quick and actually would be something we don't need to talk about here because I did a 20-minute video on it. But my Dave's Dig is the new Pearl Jam album, Gigaton. No. I had hoped to like it, but I fucking loved it. I did a pre-order, a vinyl pre-order, that came with like a 7-inch single or something. Nothing too extravagant, but I thought, oh, I'll just do a quick unboxing. What the hell, you know, in case it's... Because they do great packages for their albums and stuff. So I did that, and it turned into... So I did that. I opened it. I recorded it. It was short because it was not... You know, I mean, it was just a double album with a book and stuff. It's beautiful, but it's not like the kind of long unboxing videos that I often did. And then I went and listened to it, thinking like I'd recorded my unboxing video. That was all. And I was just so completely in love with it that I came back and I had like tabbed the giant lyric book that it came with. And I ended up doing like a 20-minute video that's like a review of sorts, as well as like me I'm just reading some of my favorite lyrical passages. So that's on the LWSD channel. So and racked up a bunch of views. I mean, not that views are everything, but it's shocking to me when we do get attention for things. And so it's got like 600 views in 2 weeks, and most of those came in the first few days. So it was
a ton of comments fun. Too. Like there's been a ton of comments generated with that. Well done, man. Really well done.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I felt really kind of silly doing it, but part of it was like I wanted to have a record of the experience I had. I just like they have no business. You two did this at their last album too. Like these guys got no business making music this good and vital this far into their career. And so, yeah, I just love that album so much, Gigaton. So if you like that idea,
the single has been playing on Alt Nation. Which we listen to a lot.
Yeah. And which one? The Super Blood Wolf Moon or the Clairvoyance one?
I think the Super Blood Wolf Moon one. And it's really good. Like, I definitely like it. It's super good. So I'm going to have to check out the whole album and give it an experience.
Yeah, it's very worthwhile. I was super taken awesome. With it. So you can check that out on our...
That's also awesome too, because I know how much Pearl Jam means to you and how much of an impact in your life that it made, that band made. And so
huge, yeah.
To still get like such refreshing content, which again we hate that word, but it is what it is. There's no other word for it. It's just what the word is for
well,
it.
Well, in
right?
this case, like, you could say music, but I get it.
Music, yeah.
I just don't like you. The idea like, of like, it. Like,
new music, new experiences for you that still,
yeah,
like plucks at your emotions the way.
Yeah,
that the
it,
other
it
stuff
was
did,
very so. Emotional for me. Yeah. I was so thrilled about it. And yeah, it's actually in some ways, you know, there are a lot of things that ring extra true for the moment that we're in and the quarantine and all that. Oh, this is just like a little selfish plug, I guess. But someone had asked me, like a newer friend asked me to make a quarantine mix. This was like early on. This is like a month ago. And so this guy doesn't know me well enough to know what a, holy shit, the comments can be displayed?
Yeah.
That seems like something we should do. Because especially with us reacting to them all the time. Oh, you have to click on them?
Yeah.
Even so, that's great. Oh, my God. Oh, that's awesome. Man, good find with this StreamYard.
Fantastic,
dude.
Right?
Really fantastic. So you should definitely click those when you find... Because, like, I'll get distracted and not see them, but I can always tell when you've seen a new one because you sort of stop dead. But if we could see it like that, it's... Holy shit. Man, that's great.
Totally
yeah,
worth
so this,
it, right? Like
totally. Oh my God. this dude asked me to create a quarantine mix. He's like, I got all this time. Oh no, I'm glad to know about that. And so I was like, okay. So he didn't know me well enough to know what a project I could make of something like that. And so
if anybody's ever seen High Fidelity,
yeah,
and him trying to name his top five albums, if you ever ask Dave to give a list of anything,
that's what's happening. You get calls you don't want,
yeah,
with replacements, yeah. Yeah. From a phone booth in the rain, and so I'm like, all right, but because I kind of like the idea, and the only way I can do it is if I do have some sort of parameters, and so I do these annual mixes that I've been doing for like 15 years or something like that, where it's just new music to me that year, and then even that has a bunch of rules. But so I started thinking about this, and I started kind of, he asked for a Spotify list, and so that's where I started sort of pulling songs, and so I ended up doing it. It took me quite a while, but I ended up, yeah. So I created the Spotify music playlist that I called Shelter in Place 2020 Quarantine Mix. And so it's all, one of the rules that I made was I was trying to make the titles flow with some kind of narrative. So I don't, there's the URL is super long, but I'll tweet it out to go with this episode. Or if you're seeing this live and are curious more quickly, you could find it on either my Instagram or Twitter pages, which is just at David Ullman. But I ended up having a lot of fun with that, and it reminded me of a lot of music that I hadn't thought of in a while, and I went through all kinds of stuff. So it's all things that I personally own. I made no attempt to be cool. Like, there's a Dave Matthews song in there, which nobody seems to like Dave Matthews, but anyway, so that was fun. There's the Dave's Digs in there that you can go check out, as well as, I guess, yeah, some music. It's like 48 songs. It's like a double CD, basically. That's how you could think of it. But it's only in Spotify right now. Do you have a Palmer's Pleasure?
If I was going to pick a Palmer's Pleasure, I would probably have to go with... So we, a few weeks ago, a couple weeks ago, we got chatted up in an old thread, a text thread, with our good show friend, a great friend of Long Walk Short Drink, Shamrock. Just talking about there's some good projects coming down the pike. Down the pipe, that are Long Walk Short Drink centered. But in that conversation came up that I had not really finished. I had not finished the John Wick trilogy, and I convinced Ash to watch that. We watched the three of them, and it is fantastic. Really, really amazing choreography in those. I love subversive, like counterculture societies or these social structures that flow below what we see as the greater world, you know, which this world of assassins, and they're so elegant that they have like a whole social structure that exists underneath our perception of what goes on in the day-to-day world. I would highly recommend, if you have not watched those, or even if you have, maybe go back and revisit them. But that John Wick trilogy, my only complaint is that every one of them ends on a cliffhanger, including the third one. So we were able to rent the first two no problem off of Amazon Prime. And then the third one is available on HBO right now, if you are a subscriber to anything that has HBO on demand on it, so that way you can get all three. But cliffhangers are bittersweet, right? Because it there's conclusion to a certain extent, but not, because it leaves you for the next one. But that also does mean that they have ideas for the next one. The only downside is whether or not those get greenlit, because although I say that's probably promising for at least a John Wick trilogy, because once the virus situation is done and things are starting to return to normal, I think Hollywood is going to be looking for anything it absolutely can to try to recoup this downtime. AMC theaters, I heard, are in discussions for bankruptcy lawyers right now, which is, they're the second largest theater chain, I believe, in the nation, and behind Cinemark, because Cinemark is still pretty stable, but AMC, bankruptcy. Wow. Discussions that
I localized that very specifically in my mind, because it was General Cinemas and then it became AMC in Fairlawn, Ohio.
Yeah.
And then across the way was, I don't remember what they called
Regal.
It. Regal. It's like Regal, yeah, and Cinemark. So it was always like one or those two, like every week,
yeah,
you know, for a few years for me.
So I think that Hollywood's going to be looking for anything it can to try to recoup as fast as possible, which I think we're going to get a lot of action and horror. There's going to be a ton of action and horror movies that are going to come out really fast, just because those are low budget, easy recoup of funds, which means I was telling Ash too, there's going to be a ton of just content in general, music, movies, art, all that's going to be isolationist centered because of this like quarantine period of time. I said this earlier on a call with a mentor of mine where I said, I believe that this is probably one of the greatest historical things that we've ever lived through. And we've lived through some pretty big historical stuff. But I think that where I am in my life, that I will see the impact of this virus for the rest of my life. Like I'll be able to trace back the world that I live in back to this time period for the rest of my life.
There's like before and after this basically.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But I'm really excited for this, this idea of, so we have this tendency that Hollywood tends to listen to our show and take ideas. So I'm really excited for this isolationist horror and action plethora of movies that are going to come out real quick once things start returning to normal, I'm interested to see what people are able to do with that genre, because I think that's just going to, those two things are going to interact, and that's just what's going to happen. That's just what we're going to see an inundation of.
I just thought of something that may or may not be of interest to you, but so Cannibalized would fit very well.
Yeah, I know.
To this
I know.
Scenario. And I know we've been talking about that as a movie, but there's something else that goes way back in the Long Walk Short Drink canon, which was like potentially doing an audio drama type thing.
Oh, yeah, like a radio show.
Yeah, but we could do that in isolation for Cannibalized.
Oh, shit.
I mean, it's a totally different approach to it.
I'll start writing. I'm going to start writing, Dave. I'm going to start writing.
Just something to think about.
I have a time travel story in my head that, like, I could do, you know, the Cannibalized story, like how much enjoyment you had of me. Well, I could do that for 3 hours about this time travel movie. Like,
I mean, that counts too. It doesn't have to be something that's like a chore. It could just be like, okay, here we go. We're starting, and
no,
we
I
do
mean,
one
like,
of these.
You know how
make
like
it happen.
Telling you all of the Cannibalized story, like on the spitballing all of it. I could do that right now with this time travel story. Like, it's so formed in my head, and it's beautiful, and just like. Oh, I love it. I love it so much. I got to get it out.
We should do that. I mean, you could do it now if you want, but we could also start one where you like just start drinking at the beginning of it.
I'm too drunk. Yeah. I'm a little drunk.
I'm on board for that. Like, on, you know, I like to make shows of things, but I've got enough shows of things to keep me busy for the next 10 years already.
So, you know, so I,
what any way you want to spin these out.
What I need to do is, if we're going to do any of them, we should probably do some private, like, hangouts, and we could just even use hangout. We don't even need to use this. Where we just kind of, I have ideas. So Cannibalized is really tough for me. Like, I'm really in like a tough position on that one. I have to see everything, like the whole pathway from A to Z, right? And I see the start. I love the juxtaposition between the two characters and how they both start differently, which is essentially the story that I told when we first conceptualized Cannibalized. What's the story? Like, I understand. I love this idea of pursuit, but what does that look like? How do they interact with each other? How do they, what's the conduit to that story? What makes sense? And what's the result of the story? What's the conclusion? I the beats, that's what I'm looking for, you know?
Yeah, that makes sense. When you shaved your mohawk for the first time a few weeks ago or whenever that was, the first thing I thought was like, oh, this is the part, and like, this is what would happen at the it's like in Taxi Driver at the end where he shaves the mohawk.
Yeah.
Because he's just like, okay, I'm basically like going on a suicide mission now. I just like, this is what happens when the cannibalized, it's a time-honored story, you know, like where you become the monster to defeat the monster type thing. But so like at first you're just pursued by the cannibal. But I like this idea of the difference, you know, this like super lean muscular guy, who maybe comes from some sort of like, maybe that's part of like his identity, is like, he's not lean because he's vain or something like that. Like, he is that way because he's got a really hard life and he works really hard all day with his hands and shit. But maybe your character is more a sedentary person who works like, you know, types of his fingers type stuff. So he hasn't had the chance to, like, you know, develop good habits to where, like, it all makes sense. But I guess what I'm saying is that by the end of it, it's that time-honored thing of where you start to become like him in order to survive.
So,
and I think what could be interesting along the way is that you thwart him nonetheless and stay alive with the skills that you have that are different than his. But by the end, you're like mohawk shaved.
I have to tell you where I'm at right now with the cannibalized. So
I'll go.
I have this idea of this like very atmospheric, suspenseful, like slow burn horror flick that takes place in a cul-de-sac. Like that's cannibalized, right? And so there's this, it's this cul-de-sac of families, and this and there's this, and that happens in the Midwest, and it's just like what's happening now, where like
I live in a cul-de-sac.
I know.
So go on.
So listen. So there's this cul-de-sac of neighbors in the Midwest, and it's in the days, and this is the like this is the spirit of the original conception of cannibalized, right? But it's in the early days of, I love the idea of not defining what is the catalyst for this. I love the illusion that it could be anything from aliens invading to a super flu to volcanic eruption, every volcano on the planet erupting to a meteorite hitting over in Europe. I don't want to define what it is. I want to just... we're just dealing with the people part of it, right? And so you have this cul-de-sac of people, and an outsider shows up that has some information that from the coasts where things are escalating faster, right? And it comes to find out that the whole movie, he's talking about this person pursuing him, that just like every time he would stop, the cannibal would show up and everybody the next morning would be dead. And like the cannibal would taunt him, and the cannibal, he's telling. And so there, it's all these flashbacks of this cannibal pursuing him from the coast to this Midwest, like cul-de-sac of like a confined amount of families, like five, like 3 to 5 families on this cul-de-sac. Right. And they're all trying, they're desperate for the information, but they're also trying to keep him at an arm's width because he's an outsider from the cul-de-sac. And like, things are weird. That's all they know, is like, things are weird, right? Like they can't get groceries, the, all that stuff. And things, the world is changing, but they just aren't getting enough information. And so they want him because he's a conduit to something that's outside of the cul-de-sac, but they also fear him because he's from outside the cul-de-sac. And as the movie is, or as the story is going on, it ultimately, they come, there's like everything comes to a head, and they decide that this person that's been pursuing them the whole time is all the fucking lie. And it's actually him. And it like, this person was actually him, and he's going to do this thing, and they're just about to fucking go crazy on it. And it forces him to do bad things. It forces them to do bad things. And it all comes down to everybody but like one person. And I haven't decided who that is yet. Everything but like one person dies. And this one person is dead. And they're in the destruction of all of the climax of the story. And all the people are dead, and you don't know if the cannibal exists. You don't know if like the cannibal, this new guy was the cannibal, or if it was a separate person, or if like anything, what's going on. And then in this, like this person's desperation, and then like the rubble and the, like the destruction of the climax of the story, I see them that are like head is down and they're like shivering. And then the camera like pans in real slow through all the destruction and the bodies. And as the camera like comes up to them, and it's like looking down of them, and they have their heads down like this, out of frame, you see a hand, and it's visible, like it's visibly the cannibal, like put his hand on the shoulder of this like lone survivor. And like, you realize that the story is like, he wants the fear of that like outsider. And he's like, are you ready like for the next one? And like, he like takes the survivor, and they're the outsider that's going to go to the next cul-de-sac to like cause the terror and to cause the, like, that's what the cannibal loves. He loves watching these, all these people tear themselves apart from this. And he like reaps the like reward of it, and like takes the one lone survivor on to the next one to create the whole thing over again. And that's what he like.
Oh my God. You know what I just heard there? I heard the sequel. Like, what I pictured ultimately, especially when you got to the end, is like the first time you talked about this, it was like, it happens. Like, this guy was waiting his whole life for society to crumble just enough to where he could act on all this. And so to me, the first one is, and now I'm not saying we have to make all these or whatever, but we could someday. but so the first one is that, it's that very one-on-one thing where you ultimately at the end, you had to become like him to defeat him, but you are the least likely, right? In a way. Cause like, I picture the Twinkie sort of cannibal as like a Henry Bowers type, you know, like a, you know, he's got that mullet and he's just like evil. But your character wouldn't necessarily look like that. You know, I would picture him more sort of like gentle, like, is it? Yeah. Ben, like the Ben character in it, you know, but instead of Ben being such, he starts as a good hearted guy, but he has to, he has to become the monster so as to not be destroyed by the cannibal. And at the end, he's got the mohawk and stuff, and he survives. And it's like, I've never seen Straw Dogs, but that's what I imagine that happens. You know, like at the end, like a normal person snaps and does horrible things to survive. But so then the next one, you have this person who is not necessarily who can, pass for just a cul-de-sac workaday guy, but who is ultimately telling the story of what we as the audience know happened to him. Well, we don't know that he's ultimately talking about himself now. And so it felt so much like a sequel to me, to where at the end, you know, you go crazy again, like maybe you were trying to suppress it, but then it is passed on to some other person who would be not so, you know, I don't know who it would be, but it'd be one of these people in this cul-de-sac in the Midwest who, again, like you wouldn't think would become a monster, but was driven to it by this situation, you know, and it's like kind of perpetuates. I don't know. I just took it away from where you had it, but that was like what I was starting to picture. It's like
this virtual series is happening. This is it. This is it.
Yeah. Oh, so how long have you been thinking like that? Since this happened, or
I think of Cannibalized in this time travel story at least 5 times a day.
Wow.
When I'm showering, when I'm like changing clothes, when I should be working, that like one of those two stories are always on my mind. Like,
oh, that's amazing. Well, the way that I understand copyright to work is as soon as something is codified, like as soon as it becomes a demonstrable physical or thing, like that could be shared, it is copyrighted.
Yeah. Like
so whether or not, yeah, these are all, yeah, all of the renditions that you've explained.
I'm going to sit on the time travel story until I have something, a product to share. Like I might share with you like rough drafts of things just as to gain insight, but the time travel story is like, I have a defined idea for a trilogy of books for this like time travel idea. And it's one of those things. I used to always say, like, could you imagine Stephen King had to write The Stand? Could you imagine being that trapped in your brain, right? Like that a story that big just being in your head, he almost would have to write just to like relieve the pressure, right? This time travel thing is like that for me. Like it's coming to that where like I almost have to do something or else I'm going to explode by how defined this is in my brain.
The best stuff,
yeah,
comes from that.
Yeah. So it's coming for sure. I just don't know when.
That's amazing. Oh, it's all so exciting. Boy, that was riveting too to imagine, especially because I do, like, I was halfway picturing, I was playing that out in my mind, and I was playing it out on my own street, and I was playing it out with the characters that I had pictured, like with you and Twinkie, basically. And then, oh man, that's exciting. And of course, the time travel one is a mystery to me.
So I mean the Cannibalized, I could see the story with the cul-de-sac being the first one and the Cannibalized story being the prequel that comes out after that, like the backstory. You know, we see like hints of that. I really think the cul-de-sac one is the more palatable of a suspenseful horror movie than this like artistic indie two character intimate piece, you know. Like we could definitely do that first. It would probably be easier for us to do that one first as an independent film. But I think commercially, if this were done in Hollywood, you would have the cul-de-sac one would come out, and then you would get the prequel that would just have the cannibal and the main character, the outsider, coming. Like that's their two like monikers, you know. This is all an homage to Fight Club. I mean, I have to be really careful that I like.
Oh, see, I don't even. That's.
I'm not. Like,
I don't picture
that
at all.
Off,
that's,
you know,
not actually a part of like my mental conception of it all. Yeah. So it's that's. I think that's a great sign.
Yeah.
That you're like, oh, I'm trying not to make it Fight Club. I was like, that never once occurred to me.
Yeah. So, I just got to be careful, but I do have to piss again. So let's do.
I'm always up for that.
Yeah, let's do another like. It's 5 o'clock here, so let's do another like 10 minutes.
Sure. Yeah, I'll go do it. I might actually, brave one more beer. It's not that I'm. I don't mind drinking on air. I just don't want to feel bad later. But
no, I'm. Anyway. I've been drinking since I had Irish coffee this morning. I've been drinking all day. So. All right, but I have
good man. Okay, but I'll be back soon. I'll turn my camera on when I'm back, just in case you're back early.
Okay.
I'll eat you up. Woo!
Well, that's epic. You're free to do that anytime.
Oh man, I'm sure my neighbors will not share in that.
I don't know, man. It's hard to argue with that kind of outburst of joy. I was thinking about something, which is we could always like these things could take any form that would be fun to us, including just being the thing that comes out verbally, you know, cannibalized on the podcast. We could always make like just a trailer. You know, like grindhouse style. Like, so you just like plot it out very carefully. I did that one time for this movie idea I had, and I did it like through school. It was called Silly, and it's called The Game of Love, and it was based on stuff I used to write down of like Jacko and Crams in high school and stuff talking about, you know, their lack of dating in life. Mine too, like as some kind of game, you know. So, and then just recently, well, I was going to say without getting the whole thing. I'll try not to, though. But I've been working on trailers. I've been cutting trailers for my own stuff. So I shot this documentary centered around this album that Cram's made. But I'm realizing that like all of the projects that I've made, so many, and then not music. Music is about what music is about. But like the film projects that I've made have all been centered around like creative expression despite, it's what I was talking about earlier, like my creativity being like my greatest gift, and that's like it's what helps me get through life. Like it's my biggest coping mechanism. And anyway, but so all the projects are about that, I'm realizing. And I've had this one documentary centering around my music for years and years that was been in a holding pattern in large for most of the duration of this podcast. Yeah, that's for Double D right there. No problem. Double D loves that, and so do I. But so it's, I just didn't know what it was about at the time. I didn't know where I was going with it to even finish it. And so it just sort of sat on a shelf. And now I kind of do know. And all these things were about the same thing, which is this creative impulse that's been with our circle of friends since as long as we've been around. Anyway, but so most recently came up with a trailer for the documentary that I made surrounding Cram's' album. And, then the thing that I finished that I could share, cause that's, I'm saving that for when his album is actually released, but, I put it into a music video, and I'm not sure if you've been listening or whatever, but I've been doing the Dreaming Out Loud outro segments with just a song, but it's always a song from like our circle of friends.
Right.
And the Dreaming Out Loud records.com like library. So this week I'll put the music video I made for that, song of his called Bloom, that I was able to turn around almost in like 24 hours. And he was like, oh, I'm gonna release this as a single and push the album. I was like, oh, I think actually with all the work I've done to create the trailer for the documentary / promo for the album, I think if I just swap a couple things around, I could have a music video for this. And so I do, and you can hear that, see that at the end of this. But once I got that trailer together, I realized I've been thinking that this documentary about his piece, which is about the same thing about mine, can be this like warm up for the project I've been working on. It's this like staged thing. But basically what I'm getting at is like, I realize I need to kind of create an infrastructure that establishes that I have made documentaries with myself as a featured subject for years, because that's part of the weird angle of all this. So, but I don't want like everything to, like, I don't want to just make the cabin documentary online or the Crow documentary or the Steve documentary. It's not really fair to the people in them and all this. So I'm like, well, if I cut together trailers, then I could help establish that as part of the meta story that this guy makes documentaries about himself. So I've been spending the last few weeks trying to make a trailer for the Crow documentary that I did. And it has been very interesting, very difficult, but really interesting to like distill it down to its thing. So that's maybe that's why my brain is in this mode. But I was just starting to like, we had our little break and I'm peeing and I'm just like seeing it. I'm seeing it like a grindhouse trailer. Because like then you don't have to have the beats. Not really.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You just need the overarching thing and then you plot it out and then you can shoot it like in a weekend or something.
Well,
so, we'll see.
That's like your opinion, man. I mean,
is that a tum? Is that a pint size white Russian?
Of course it is.
Oh, shit. That's great. Oh, my God. I got to at least.
No, it's a pint size white Caucasian.
Mm. Oh, Jackie.
That's... You make a mean Caucasian.
Anyway, sorry. I got off on that tangent, but I was thinking about trailers and. I was like, how can we make this a thing? So that's just one other way.
I want a treatment. That's really what I want. So honestly, I think the Culdesac one is the more palatable. I want that one to work. And that's going to give us the freedom to be able to do the prequel the way we want to do the prequel, which is the like I really envision, and I've never even watched this fucking movie. what's the movie with I thought you succumbed that movie.
Oh, Jerry.
Yeah,
I have like, that on DVD back there.
So like that's two guys just wandering through the desert.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like that's Cannibalized. Like I'm envisioning this like survivalist horror minimalist like really uncomfortable plod, and it's just not what you start with. You start with the cul-de-sac story and you move into that, like you get that other one as like backstory.
Oh shit, I was just realizing we could almost have our cake and eat it too in that. Yeah. We'll put that one up. Kick fucking ass, man. I got a MasterCard.
A fucking MasterCard. And then like it's... 40 minutes later, he's like, I owe $500 the MasterCard.
It's so fun. There's several things about that. One of which is when I was trying to make this trailer.
I would have pissed myself. Moto, you have no
good
idea.
Good call, man.
Oh, man.
Does that mean though that you've seen that movie now? Because I don't think that's in the trailer.
Oh, fucking A MasterCard.
That is my template actually for the Crow like trailer I was making. I actually put in the American movie trailer, which is just gold. Well, he put cake. I don't know what that means.
Oh, I know what that means. We know what that means.
I thought I was like, how does that answer whether or not you've seen the movie? But I get it now.
What was that?
Oh, so what I was
this
thinking.
This is interesting. This is interesting.
Oh, maybe it
isn't.
Like, maybe it isn't. That's fucking interesting. That's fucking interesting. So we could have both in the cul-de-sac version where you don't know he's talking about this other person and you don't know that it's him.
But it's not him. I want the whole first until the last 10 seconds. I want there to you to think that there's a cannibal, and then the whole third act is you not knowing, you thinking there's no fucking cannibal, it's just that asshole the whole time. And then he dies and all that's left is I picture this kid left, one of the kids from the cul-de-sac. And the kid's like got his head down in this like rubble, like literal rubble, bodies, destroyed houses. And the kid's like bloody and dirty and naked. And the camera just like pans across all this rubble. You see all these bodies, all these characters that we just cared about for the last 2.5 hours, just like all just dead and dismembered and fucking dead. And it, and like, and you think the body at the last second, the camera pans over the body of the cannibalized, the guy, the outsider of the cul-de-sac. So it's confirming that what you're about to see cannot be him, even though the last third act of the movie, we were led to believe it was him the whole time. There was no cannibal. It was actually this outsider, right? And so the camera pans over his body to this kid, the last survivor of the cul-de-sac. And out of frame, a dirty hand like slams the like poker pry bar, the weapon of the cannibal, like into the ground, and puts their hand on the shoulder of the kid and is like,
"Are you ready?"
And like has that like, that like Kylo Ren style voice, like,
"We need to move on."
And it's like he's recruiting this kid to be the outsider for the next cul-de-sac.
The and next, you realize like, it is the cannibal? Like it is Twinkie?
It was real. The person was real the whole time. I don't want there to be any ambiguity. I want there to be like, no, the cannibal exists. The outsider was telling you the truth the entire time. And then, so that movie ends. And the next movie is the prequel, which is The Cannibal and the Cannibalized, which is that original story I told you about, where it's just that intimate piece that ends with him, like the cannibalized, like climbing over this like hillside and looking down on the cul-de-sac. That's about to, which was the movie we already saw.
Oh, nice. Because what I was starting to imagine then was having both, in that you have, it plays with that audience thing of like, is this guy the real guy or the cannibal?
That's
is he
all
telling
the
truth?
First movie, but yeah. The first movie ends with you knowing the cannibal existed. So then the second movie, we get to see what led to the first one, which was The Cannibal and the Cannibalized, that original movie that I told, that like trek, which would be the trek essentially from a coast where everything's going down. And we see that initial shot of like the cannibal and the cannibalized, like really embracing their roles of what's about to happen. And I just see this like cat and mouse game of the cannibal just really fucking with the can, almost like The Hitcher. Remember that like old movie?
Oh, I've never actually seen that, but I've always wanted to, with C. Thomas Howell and
Rutger
Hauer.
Yeah. So like there's just it's this like every time you in The Hitcher, every time that you think C. Thomas Howell is about to like he's getting a step ahead, you realize that like Rutger Hauer was 4 steps ahead of him. And that's what I envision The Cannibal and the Cannibal, like Cannibalized, that prequel movie after the cul-de-sac movie. That's what that is like this cat and mouse game from the coast to the cul-de-sac of like my character being antagonized by Twinkie the entire time of like, he's just messing with me. This is all for fun. This is all him enjoying the like fall of society. And that's really what that movie is about, is where we start from a coast where everything is great and then just devolves down to that cul-de-sac, to by the time they get to the cul-de-sac, their roles of I'm going here to just stir the pot so you can enjoy yourself. That's really what the roles were leading into the cul-de-sac of the first movie, was the cannibal had Stockholm syndromed my character into like, I'm going to go like just stir the fucking pot so you can sit back and enjoy the show. Like,
oh yeah, so that is kind of what I was starting to picture. And maybe this is best as two movies, but I was starting to picture it as one, where it plays with the back and forth and the timeline, where you start to see that transition of your character into trying to become the cannibal so as to survive. And then at the end, you realize, like, that's where it all, like, comes together. So they sort of develop in tandem to where at the end you see that your character, because we can play with that thing of your character being the mild-mannered guy that would blend in with the cul-de-sac, because that's who he was before the cannibal, like, came into his life.
And so he is telling this story. They want more information. In the first movie, they want more information. They're cut off from what's happening on the coasts, right? He's the conduit to that. And all he keeps coming back to are these stories of the cannibal. And at first, they're really, like, gobsmacked by these stories. And then as the tension builds, as more stories are told and more, like, horrific things are found out about what's actually happening with the fall of society, in through that process, they start to believe that there's no cannibal at all. This outsider is actually describing things he's done, things he's seen, and they turn on him. And that turns to a whole devolution of their structure that they've built in the cul-de-sac, to where even he gets caught up in that crossfire and killed. And there's another survivor. And you think, we even as an audience, we believe he was the cannibal. There was no cannibal. He was actually just confessing to terrible things that he had done in his progress from the coast where this had, whatever it was, had started.
I finally got the Fight Club part of it. Because that was what I was starting to imagine, this, like, parallel thing where you're seeing it develop, you're seeing it develop, and you're seeing this guy
so
as a real guy, and then you realize
him.
It's Tyler
Durden.
We think
it's him, and it cuts to the... But in this last shot, as the camera is panning over the chaos that this whole movie has built up to, it pans over his body, and there's another survivor, somebody left of the cul-de-sac. And a hand comes down and puts their hand on that shoulder of that survivor. And you realize Tyler Durden and the narrator were actually two separate people. That's the reveal.
Yeah,
that's the reveal. Is that actually he was telling the truth the entire time. And then the second movie is all those things that he had talked about that we had begun to doubt in the third act of the first movie, the cul-de-sac movie. That first movie actually explores all of those things. We see that progression of, like, all the pieces of his story that he didn't get to tell from the coast to that cul-de-sac. And that, and really the message is, this is all for fun of the cannibal. He's Pennywise. He likes to salt his meat with the, like, the fear and the, like, angst, right? Before he, like, goes in for the kill. And then he recruits the next one, and he just thrives on that chaos. He is the, another good example would be the judge from Blood Meridian, you know, like this.
Oh, it's been too long for me.
The ageless stranger in The Stand. Like, he thrives. He almost feeds on the chaos that he creates more than the actual, like, body count. You know,
yeah, I was starting to imagine the cannibal as a little bit of, like, a Jason from the Friday the 13th type vibe.
Or not so much
the ongoing story.
But no. I don't like that supernatural aspect. Just that he enjoys the, like, playing with his, like, food. You know, like he wants, and even if he doesn't get to eat, he's okay with that. Even if all his food ends up killing each other, that's all right.
Huh. Or like the Joker, then, I guess. He's like the dog. Yeah. Wouldn't know what to do if he caught the car. But just, like, thrives on the chaos. Some men just want to watch the world burn.
Oh, man.
Holy man. Wow. That was epic.
we should talk Mandalorian and then wrap it, I think.
Yeah. I promised Double D, though, I'd tag up on the Mystery Science Theater. He reached out to me. And so maybe I can do a little JCVD and me.
What Mystery Science Theater? What are you talking about? Let's do that now.
So this, we'll do this JCVD and me corner, which I don't have anything for, but maybe I can come up with some sort of like stinger. But so news with Jean-Claude Van Damme and myself as it relates. Last episode, or recently anyway, I talked about I had the opportunity to go to see a live, this was the last thing I did before quarantine, I guess, though I didn't necessarily realize it before now. Got to see a live touring production of Mystery Science Theater.
Oh, wow.
And the movie, and I actually went, I do like that series, of course, but I went to see it because the movie was No Retreat, No Surrender, Jean-Claude Van Damme's screen debut. Not in Breaking, but like with a speaking role. And so it was here in Minneapolis, and I went to see it, and it was, I just pulled it up because there's so many different, so it was, let's see, The Great Cheesy Movie Circus Tour, and it's Joel Hodgson and the World's Greatest and Only Movie Riffing Robots, Tom Servo, Crow, and Gypsy. And I think they just took this movie and one other, like, all across the country. So it was No Retreat, No Surrender, and they would play the movie, and we saw it at the, like, where we'd see, you know, theater, like bands play. Like, I saw Cigarose and came midway through and left almost immediately because it was too many hipsters a few years ago. But exactly. That's what I think of when I go. Oh, I saw Mark. Oh my God! Yes. Anyway, so we went there to see. I went to see No Retreat, No Surrender on the big screen, and boy did I. And when so they did show the movie, and actually the version they showed was the European one. There's a great like Blu-ray that came out like in 2014 of No Retreat, No Surrender that has a much longer version that came out outside of America, which is some weird shit, honestly, left in it for people who know that movie. Well, I can't remember which version they showed now. Anyway, but they would show the movie just like on TV, and then they would interject. So like the skits with Mystery Science Theater 3000 folks would be in person on stage, and then they would go to the movie and come back and forth. But they would do live commentary from the side of the stage. And it was fucking hilarious. Like, the bride too just loved it. Like, we could not stop laughing the whole time. Their comments on that movie, which is funny in and of itself, like, were so funny. And there is actually a riff tracks for No Retreat, No Surrender, and I thought maybe it'd be the same thing, because I looked into it after, because I was like, I love this so much. If I could somehow watch this whenever I wanted, I'd be so happy. And it's not. It was completely different, and it was utterly hilarious. And it was a one of a kind thing, so it's not like something you can go out and
so
enjoy.
Does that motivate you to seek out more Mystery Science Theater 3000? Like, there because
it should, but mostly I was just excited to see Jean-Claude Van Damme on the big screen, or No Retreat, No Surrender, I should say. My favorite Mystery Science Theater 3000 is actually Alien from L.A. That's where I was introduced to it, and it was a movie I knew. With Kathy Ireland, who I was obsessed with at the time, 1988 movie directed by Albert Pian, who directed Cyborg.
I know all this. I know all this because
right
of you.
Before Cyborg.
Yeah.
So that was the one I knew and loved, and it's still the only one I really know really well. I do like it. I like the format. I you know, with all the millions of thousands of things I'm making, I don't have time to watch a lot of stuff, so I have to be really selective. What was I saying? Oh, so I talked to Double D on the phone, and you know, how he was doing in quarantine and stuff. And he's like, you got to talk about the Mystery Science Theater experience. So so there it was. I think at some point in the show, they actually kind of passed the mantle from Joel to someone else. So that, like, yeah, it could be carried on. He's like, this is my last kind of thing. It was cool to see, like, when the Van Damme's name was on the screen, like, you could see, like, people cheered. They took up, like, you could see people take snap, like, flash photos, and there was a Van Damme themed drink, which is neat. And so, yeah, so there you go, Double D. There's that bit of business. And then also in JCVD news, I don't think we mentioned this last time, but our Jean Pod Van Damme cast crossover episode finally surfaced on their show. So, John and Jeff presented our conversation from August as their latest episode on the Jean Pod Van Damme cast. And sadly, they're actually retiring the podbros.com and Podbros Network at the end of this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You know, just one of those things. Like, they started up in 2013, so it had a really long and great run. And I just thought, I discovered that show, the Jean Pod Van Damme cast, when they already were pretty much almost done. And so I wanted, I was like, I don't want to, I want someone else to be able to have this experience. I had so much fun with that show. And so I reached out to him similarly to how I did with the others on Pod Van Damme cast, or Jean-Pod Van Damme, I think was what that one was called. Anyway, with Marcus Jones. And I was like, I will help. I'd love to help you get this on YouTube where you don't have to pay for the service fees or whatever. You don't have to pay for the hosting. Yeah. So I think by the time this drops on the Pod Bros YouTube site, you can listen to the whole run of their 117 episodes where they go through not only Jean-Claude Van Damme's filmography one episode at a time, but they start to go through things like the Kickboxer sequels and the Bloodsport sequels and these sort of ancillary things. Like they go through Jean-Claude Van Johnson one episode at a time.
Oh, man.
They go through.
Well, they were doing the
reality
show too. Weren't they like I wanted to do. I wanted to be on their fucking Mandy episode. Like,
I know, and I think they said they did that early on. So, he was saying that John was telling me that maybe they would put those then on the YouTube channel as well. Like the one because they wanted to like bank a bunch and then start to roll them out, but they never rolled them out. So, already though on podcast sites. Well, actually, yeah, who cares? Like once this is live, you can go to their YouTube channel and find both our show.
Good deal.
And all the
good
others.
Deal.
And hopefully the Rage in a Cage and Every Day I'm Wrestling, which is the Kurt Russell. I don't know. I haven't heard those yet, but
no, that's awesome.
If I have anything to do with it, which I may well, we're gonna get those out. So what else? The training videos that Jean-Claude Van Damme did that I screen scraped and we talked about a couple years ago or whatever.
Yeah.
He's now putting on YouTube. There you can actually see them. So if you want to see his, you know, bad hair dye job and the exercise routine that he came up with that's now no longer you know, wiped from the internet. He's doling it out. And I guess it came after some injury he had where he was helping to heal himself or get back and not heal himself. Well, probably the hear him say is like, because he did say at some point in that thing, he was like, you can make yourself almost invincible. But anyway, so I would be curious to see as they roll those out if all the things that I put in that like super cut of things that made me laugh, you know, like is it going to be in the lesson that they put on YouTube where he says that thing where he's like, I was kidnapped once in Russia, and he talks about how he escaped.
That is, if he's gonna that cut story that out. Is amazing.
You could totally tell in that moment that he did not anticipate talking about it, but they don't cut it out, and it's at the end of like a lesson. He's like, I'll talk to you soon. And he just leaves after saying like, oh, if I had not survived that, my teeth would be in a lake and my body fed to the pigs. I'll talk to you next time. So we'll see. Anyway, but so you can see all that on his YouTube channel. And then the last thing I thought to maybe go out on, if we can maybe watch this together, Van Damme is making these things and putting them out on YouTube that he's calling like Damn Bro or whatever. They're just like these ridiculous videos that he's making with his kids. So his sons direct them and are in them, and he plays some kind of like goofy superhero. There's like 2 minutes long, but they're like, one of them is they're in quarantine type videos. So this is called JC's Day Out. Let me see if I can share this and we can watch this together and then maybe talk some Mandalorian and hopefully we can hear it.
No, I need the video. I need the video file, and I can do that.
Oh, is it not working? Or is it working enough that we could talk about it?
Well, like you see him, right? We can't hear it. We can't hear anything that's going on, though.
Oh, okay. That's all right. There's silly music. We'll just talk over it. That makes sense. So you're just hearing, like, kind of old 40s, 50s type music. He's walking, like, shaking his arms here.
Hey, JC!
This guy goes, hey, JC! He's like, high five!
Blah!
I'll just make the noise. It's fun. Thank you, JC. So,
yeah.
That's the through line through all this. He keeps going like,
yeah.
Really pronounced. He's like, no way, Jean-Claude Van Damme. You're the way. You're
yeah,
the
no
man.
Sound.
High five.
No sound. Yeah, some. I love Dave's narration, though.
You don't need it. I can hear it. I'll
yeah.
Hear it.
Yeah.
Jean-Claude. Down here.
There's
here.
More like Jean-Claude. Now there's like, that's one of his kids pretending to be a little person. He just kicks him in the face and goes on about his business. All right, so this may be too much to watch in this fashion. All right, I'm going to go ahead and pause it, but we can go back. But you get the idea. So you can watch this if you look up Jean-Claude Van Damme's YouTube or Facebook page or probably Instagram, all that stuff. But it's been really funny to see him and his kid just doing nonsense. The next one, he actually wears like a towel as a cape that says maybe JC in the back. I'm not sure. He goes out and saves dogs, kicks people, and goes, yeah, the whole time. So there you go. That's JCVD and me.
Oh, yeah. So you want to work out? all right. So, all right. I, months ago, at the height of the Mandalorian, as distant as we are from the Tiger King, we are triple that distance from the Mandalorian.
Easily.
Easily. Anyway, so when that was at its height, I was even still slow.
I don't know. I'm going to get another beer.
All right.
My last one.
This is my sixth one. Two of them, though.
Talk to you, buddy, too.
It's like 9%. The other ones were like 7.7.
And you had that fucking Caucasian.
That Caucasian with vodka, Kahlua, and there's another liquor in there.
Liquor, I barely know.
Anyways.
Do you get hangovers from this business? Like I'm like a
no,
two glass of wine.
It's still daytime. I'll drink a lot of water. I'll be fine.
Be all right.
I'll be fine. Man, you gotta hydrate. It's all about hydration, man.
Like, so I thought, but I've done a lot of experimenting and it just doesn't fly for me. I'm old. It's all right.
All right. So back in the height of it, I was trying to tease you into the Mandalorian. Because by episode 2, I was like, this is a show that Dave is going to love. Not just love, but just, like on a level of the original trilogy, I feel like. Like it's just, it was such a Dave show while I had this empathy while I was watching it where I was like, this needs to be consumed by Dave as fast as possible. Because I think this is exactly the kind of content from Star Wars that just goes up his alley. So I'm interested to talk Mandalorian with you a little bit, as drunk as I am. Jesus.
Well, rather than go episode by episode, why
no,
don't
that's
you
not
maybe,
gonna happen.
Yeah, ask me what you've been curious about, and then we'll kind of go from there.
Well, I'm just like, as a whole, what's your initial take on the show?
For some reason, I was not especially like gung ho to watch it, which is why it took this long for me to see it. I have no idea why that is. It just wasn't something I was chomping at the bit to see. So there's that, and I think I carried that into it. The first episode, I was like getting excited. You know, there's a Life Day mention, which I just saw the Star Wars Christmas special this year on YouTube. So I was like, oh my God, they're acknowledging that. There was, portable carbonite freezing. There was like Carl Weathers, fucking Apollo Creed shows up early on. Werner Herzog is there. I'm just like, what is happening? Nick Nolte is a troll. Like I was on board for so much of it. And actually the Mandalorian himself, I was seriously, because I didn't know and I hadn't looked into it, but I was pretty sure this wasn't the case. I was like, is that John Cusack's voice? So I started picturing the John Cusack character from Gross Point Blank, which is one of my favorite movies. He's a hired hitman in that movie. So I just pictured the whole series. I pictured Martin Blank as the Mandalorian, and it was glorious. So those are some of the like super positive things that I would say. It was really nice to see the attention to detail of all of those like little fan service-y type stuff.
Yeah. There was a lot of fan service. I'm going to acknowledge that.
Oh, like, yeah. And I'm on board for that. I have no problem with that kind of stuff. Like, that's I am a fan.
Right.
Like, that's what I want that stuff. I didn't love it. Like I didn't like it as much as The Bride, actually.
Okay.
And when I said that, she was like, "What?" And I don't remember at what point I said that to her. But she's like, "It just feels to me like a kind of a weekly show." I don't remember what she said, but I started to think of it because I think I thought there's so much amazing television and we watch a lot of it. We talk about a lot of it. I think I thought that this would be on the level of like the cinematic Star Wars. And I'm not, that's not to downgrade it. I really hate the idea of people, you know, Moto's watching. I know, like, so I love the fact that like my Uncle Jack would come over.
It was a space western.
A what? Space Western. Yeah, totally. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, and I loved a lot of that.
As Moto says.
Yeah.
It is such a Western. I mean, it's like, it's surprising how, to me, it's surprising how popular it was because it is such a Western. Predominantly
like,
are not popular. They have not been popular with American audiences, and there's no other way to describe this movie. That is what this is. It's a Western.
Space Western. Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of a space opera.
Yeah.
Like Star Wars was.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was ultimately like where I came around by the end to feel like to really kind of contextualize it in a way that I could fully appreciate. So I think I thought it was going to be on the level of like the cinematic movies that have been coming out. Like, And that's not to say that it's bad, but there was one episode that even The Bride was like, I feel like I'm watching Star Trek: The Next Generation.
Yeah,
like the one where they went to rescue the prisoner or whatever. That was the one where we were thinking.
Yes, Motor, you're right.
But I was also thinking about I started, at first I had it in like this negative context, but then I started to think about it more positively, and it was reminding me of like something you would see on the WUAB or like Renegade or Hercules or fucking Cobra with Michael Dudikoff, like these, or the Bandit series, like these kind of like they're syndicated shows that you would see Street Justice with Carl Weathers that were on like every week. And then I was like, oh man, shit, this is a little bit like, in some ways, some spin on the serialized like Flash Gordon type Saturday matinee thing that Star Wars was originally an homage to, like Flash Gordon. And so even that, as I say it all out loud, it sounds a bit more like highfalutin than I mean it. But I guess I wanted to love it more than I did. And there were parts of it I really did like, but I think I thought it was going to be kind of different. And I'll say like, I didn't like it near as much as any of the films that have come out, which I've loved all of those.
That's fair, first off. Second off, by this like fifth or sixth episode, the one with Bill Burr when they're on the space station.
Yeah, that was the one, yeah.
That was the one where I'm like, this has been, every episode has been the same show, the same story, just told in a different way every time. Then by the next episode, that was all setting up the payoff for the last like three episodes of this series. And I really think the next season is really what's going to define that show. It's really, that's where it's going to be really episodic. I think that's what needs to happen, is each one needs to be self-contained and just really move forward this mythos of what happens between the Mandalorian. Jesus, I'm so drunk. I'm so sorry.
That's all right. It's exciting. It's fun.
I love all of you so much. Jesus, I love you.
Love you too, buddy. Go on.
But that's really where I feel like the second season should just progress the relationship in the aging of the kid. Like, we should get a different kid by the end of the second season. Like developmentally different, you know. I think to progress it,
I was conflicted because I was kind of messed up on the timeline. So I did not like the idea that it was a baby Yoda, because that's what everyone was saying. I was thinking like it was a literal, this is baby Yoda as we know Yoda.
No, it is separate. If I understand it right, that so the kid, as he's referred to in The Mandalorian, came to existence the same time Anakin Skywalker did.
Oh, okay.
Because he's 50 years old. Like, at the start of, like, he's a baby, sure. But he's 50, right? Like, so,
something about the way he said, yeah, he's a baby, I could listen to forever.
He's a baby. I'm so fucking drunk, man. Can we just wrap this up soon?
Of course. Yeah. No, I mean, I liked it. I didn't like it as much as I had hoped to, but there's so much about it. Like, Moto and, so, like, my Uncle Jack would come over to my parents' house, and they would all gather and, like, watch it as on the weeks it came out. I love thinking of that happening. And I like this. I love this idea of this, like, weekly serial, and it doesn't have to be, in my mind now, in
you
the
know,
same
Moto,
plane as
you know, Moto, you're exactly right. The So we have the post 7, 8, 9. There's no reference to the kid at all. So we know this has to end where all of those characters are removed from the Skywalker saga, right? Like, regardless of how the series progresses through, they won't make it to episode 7. So, because this is in the timeline between Jedi and 7, this is like right after Jedi, the fall of the Empire. So this story has a limitation. It has an end point to it because we don't see the kid. Now, what we could see is Rey and Finn and Poe finding the kid as an adolescent, like in a side arc, you know, like in the next trilogy that's not associated with the Skywalker saga, right? Like, they could end up back together. But I like that. I don't think it's Yoda's child. I think it's either a clone of Yoda or it's a separate, like, member of Yoda's species. Because there's only been two of Yoda's species that are in canon. Yoda and then, I forget, like, Marla or something.
I didn't know there was another. Interesting.
She's in episode 1, but the implication is that his species, every member of his species, is tuned to the Force, like they're Force sensitive. So he either is a clone of Yoda or he is just another member of Yoda's species. Regardless of the fact he is Force sensitive, I would love to see this, like, this merge of the stories where they bring Rey and Poe and Finn, which, by the way, did you fucking see that J.J. Abrams and John Boyega both confirmed that what he wanted to tell Rey was that he was Force sensitive and not that he was in love with Rey, that he was Force sensitive, which is what I said on the episode 9 reaction, and was shot down multiple times, multiple fucking times. Even J.J. Abrams said that's what he wanted to tell Rey. J.J. fucking Abrams!
I have heard that also.
I know you didn't fight me, Moto. We all know who fucking fought me on that.
I don't remember. Was it me?
No.
Was it me? Oh, okay. Oh, then I know.
But I know I'm fucking right!
Force fucking sensitive! Not that he loved her! Moto, I love you. Dave, I love you.
Also, actually, you were talking about the Skywalker saga. I'm looking over there at my force is weak with me, so I can't pull it over, but there's the Rise of Skywalker Blu-ray, and there's a feature-length documentary called The Skywalker Saga, which I think will trace everything. But yeah, I think I like it more in retrospect, having seen it, than I did at times watching it. But I did like it. I think my just expectations were kind of wonky.
Love you, buddy. Love you, Moto. Love you, Dave.
Love you also.
I'm just telling you. So there were some great things in The Mandalorian. I think part of the apprehension, and this is my problem with The Mandalorian, is Disney is retconning some of what was accepted expanded universe and what was accepted canon. They've retconned that and made that like what is called Legends, which is not expanded, not canon anymore. So a great example of that ties directly to The Mandalorian. The fact that Boba Fett and Jango Fett. Boba Fett is not an actual Mandalorian. He stole that armor in canon now that exists since Disney has bought Lucasfilm. Boba Fett is not actually a Mandalorian. We have found out that he stole that armor and that he proposed to be a Mandalorian but wasn't actually one. What we're seeing from the show, The Mandalorian, are true Mandalorians, right?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And so I think the show is just so, the fact that it's taking its time. There was a Disney executive who said the future of Star Wars is on Disney Plus and it is episodic storytelling.
Yeah, I can see. I mean, it's one of their, like, you sign into Disney Plus and there's a handful of things you can select, almost like sub channels, and one of them is Star Wars. Just the other day, like when I was going to watch the last episode,
man. So drunk.
When we went to watch the last one, I clicked on Star Wars as one of the sub channels, thinking like, oh, I messed up, but then no, I didn't. But there's so many other Star Wars things you can watch. I don't even want to get into it, but so I could see that, and that was the thing. So even though I think my biggest gripe in some ways was that it wasn't emotionally involving for me. The all of the movies that have come out in the last few years have been very emotionally involving for me. And this wasn't, even at the climax, which is like, I'm not leaving you. I'm like, I should be bawling right now. And I'm not.
Yeah.
But that's okay. Like, that's when I was like kind of coming around to this idea of like, if this is like the WUAV, you know, action theater, whatever weekend thing, appointment viewing version of Star Wars that expands the universe, like, I'm all for that, and I will watch this happily as that or whatever it is. Like, I just need to not, I don't know, I kind of reframed it towards the end to where I was able to appreciate it even more. But yeah, I sorry it took me so long to get around to, but I'm glad to have seen it now and be part of the the experience, the larger experience. I'll certainly tune in time when it comes back. I think for our next edition of this, we should talk Cobra Kai with Moto. It'll be out. It'll have been out enough.
What? Wait. When is the third season of Cobra Kai coming out? Is it going to be out?
Like next week or at the end of next week? I think.
You're bullshitting me.
We just found this out. I think the 24th. Because he was saying something in the chat.
Cobra Kai Season 3! Woo!
Oh, shit. All right.
Oh, my goodness.
Fuck! Woo! All right. You got anything else on Mandalorian?
No. Got it? No.
Top that shit!
Nothing.
No, it's nothing. Top not that. A goddamn thing. You got that right. You got that fucking right. Oh, man. All right. I got to get off here before I make a fool out of myself. First off, feel free to email us at lwsdpod@gmail.com. You can subscribe with us at youtube.com/longwalkshortdrink. Subscribe. Make sure you ring the bell. We have found a new way that we're going to be able to live stream our episodes again like we used to be able to do. So make sure you ring that bell so every time we go live, you'll get notified with that. Okay. Head over to audibletrial.com/LWSD for Long Walk Short Drink. Sign up for your free Audible trial. Get your free audiobook. I would recommend in this time, honestly, I would get the the updated and revised edition of The Stand. I think that would be a great fit for what we're going through right now with the COVID situation. I think absolutely The Stand would be a great fit for where we are right now. Head over to twitter.com and find us at LWSD Pod. We tweet out all of the Dave will go back and he will actually refine a nice audio version podcast of this conversation that he will tweet out as our official episode number 84. So head over to our Twitter, who follow us there. Head over to iTunes.com/LWSD. Search Long Walk Short Drink. Leave us a review there, or Stitcher, or what was the newest one that we just got?
Oh, yeah, we're on Spotify now. Spotify. Actually, that made a big difference for Spotify. Some folks, I heard.
Leave us some kind of review. That's going to really just, like, the more reviews we get, the more it's going to open up to other people. Listen, this is just an excuse for me to be able to talk to my friends that I love and who I've been making shit with for the last 20 years. But the more people that get exposed to that, I really find can relate to what we're talking about and what we're trying to do. And I love getting those stories back about the things that they've made with their friends over the course of years and decades. So make sure you're checking all those different places out. You're leaving those reviews. Because the more exposure that we get to more people, the more that relate to us and the more audience that we get, we're going to keep recording these conversations, whether or not nobody listens to them or not. But I really think there's something here for people to relate to and people to connect with. Thanks so much for listening. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'm so fucking drunk.
I've never seen you this drunk. It's intense.
Yeah. Woo! Awesome. But thank you so much, everybody, seriously, for joining us. Moto, Jacko, we had the Pod Bros on earlier.
Oh, yeah, and Double D. Double D
on earlier. Like, that was, this is honestly, like, this was a piece that I didn't realize I was missing so much from our podcast. So thanks so much. Looking forward to this just getting better as we move on. So,
right.
Long walk.
Love you, buddy.
Yep,
cheers, Long Walkers.
Yep. Cheers, Long Walkers. And we'll see you Long Walk Short Drink in May.
they say, bloom where you're planted, stay where you're wanted. It's easy, I say, keep chasing the wild, be now and always a child. It's easy. Goes by, and we know where it leads. You and I know we don't talk anymore, but you still know me. You still know. I hope it's what you wanted. I know it wasn't easy. I kept chasing the wild. I never had no child. It's not easy.